elbow blows, and so do the bills. Oh!
Yeah. This is Joey Buttafuoco for Buttafuoco's Complete Auto Body, with a reminder to you that I'm still open for business and ready to service you in many different ways. We'll paint your car while you wait. Now, what other body shop can offer you that? Not to mention you can wait upstairs in my freshly appointed bedroom. Now you see why it's called Complete Auto Body. And parents, remember that I still have the Joey Coco Pops Sweet 16 Special. Just bring your daughters down to the shop for any body work they may need, and I'll treat them to a free pizza and a ride in my boat. And for those of you that are concerned about that Fisher bitch, here's a few comforting words from my loving wife, Mary Jo.
Joey didn't do nothing. The bitch shot me.
So, if you want me to smoke a damage estimate on your car, just call 1-800-WHAT. I didn't do nothing. That's 1-800-1. I didn't do nothing.
Hey, stench of cow manure hovers over this performance by the Dolphins.
Absolutely.
We should just play that the whole 3.5 hours, you know it?
All right, it'll loop.
Right up till 2 o'clock. Well, Clarence was in there this morning beseeching me, oh, come on, just once for us, do a Dolphin show. Do a Bash the Dolphin show for 3.5, whatever you're on.
Go for it.
No. Why do we want to do that?
I could see one.
He just doesn't get it. He just don't get it. Just like they don't get the fact that not all of Neil Rogers' audience listens to the Stern Show, unfortunately, which we wish they did. But also not all. We got a very large percentage of our audience who, number one, aren't Dolph fans, including me. And number two, we also have a bunch of people that don't care about football or the NFL or sports in general. All of these things. How do you like that?
All of these
those
things.
Words have no meaning.
Oh, I see. That's right, because they have nothing to do with sports. I forgot that. Yeah, Clarence is just a sports nerd. He's just a hurricane nerd. That's all he'll ever be. It's very sad. And he's kind of like slipped this last week with that great performance on my check last week. He kind of slipped several notches down the ladder. This you got a lot of work to do. Bad news right off the bat. We don't want to start on a bad note. In fact, how about those Dolphins?
Oh!
See, that's a better note. We will take all and any calls today bashing the Dolphins, though, to make Clarence happy. And it'll make me happy, too, because that was my favorite moment of the game was when... I still can't believe it. I have it on tape. I better go in the other room and watch it again. When Fiedler put the ball on the ground when he lateraled it. Now you got to feel for Feely and Fiedler, right? Because the offensive line's about as offensive as the kids. They got no protection, man. It's kind of like, okay, guys, come on in there and just nail their ass, you know?
Scored an amazing 9 points.
Yeah, and that's pretty heavy duty for them. Four games, I believe it's 29 points. Am I right? Is that the correct total, 29 points in four games? That's a touchdown a game, baby.
Oh!
What's not to like?
Doing great.
But when he tried to lateral or whatever he was trying to do and just his last fumble there, just kind of put it on the ground, that was a beautiful thing. What did I tell you about Fiedler and Feely and all that crap? I don't understand how come nobody got fired yet. Is that possible? Am I out of touch, out of the loop?
Yes.
Aren't you shocked that if the Wanstead era continues?
Something we don't know.
There must be something going on that hasn't gotten announced yet, but it's got to be. What all's that? So we're back to that crap again? With that, is that on your end or mine?
What you talking about?
No, it's on my end, that phone thing.
Oh.
Anyway, here's the bad news. Psycho star Janet Lee dies at 77.
Oh, my God.
Nobody don't like Janet Lee, right?
Why'd you call her a psycho?
Because she's dead and she can't fight back. Hollywood movie star Janet Lee, best known as the slasher victim in the 60 Alfred Hitchcock thriller Psycho, has died. A spokeswoman for her daughter, actress Jamie Lee Curtis, said yesterday. Today, Jamie Lee died peacefully in her home Sunday afternoon.
Jamie
said the
Lee.
Is that what I said?
Yeah.
Jamie Lee is dead? Boy, they're dropping like flies.
God.
It's a great lead into our poll today, you know? Janet Lee, that's what I said. I saw that gaslight. And you ain't no Charles Boyer either. Peacefully died in her home Sunday afternoon, said the spokeswoman, Heidi Schaefer. Lee, 77, died in her Beverly Hills home, surrounded by daughters Jamie Lee and Kelly Curtis, and her fourth husband, Robert Brandt, Schaefer said. Lee had been battling vasculitis and inflammation of the blood vessels for a year. What the hell is vasculitis?
Didn't you just say an inflammation
of the blood vessels? Inflammation of the blood vessel. I never heard of that. Lee married Brandt in 1962 after an 11-year marriage to actor Tony Curtis.
Veteran actress Jen.
Sorry.
Boy, you are just out of control.
Died like Sunday
coffee.
Following a year-long battle.
Man, oh, man. Just hit him in the head with that baseball bat in the corner there, would you please, Josh? God. In fact, I'd just lay back and let you do it today. You sound like you're all wound up.
Yeah, I'm all bound up. Well,
yeah,
not anymore.
In addition to Psycho, Lee appeared in other films such as The Manchurian Candidate, Bye Bye Birdie, Little Women, Toward a Touch of Evil. More recently, she appeared in Halloween, age 20, 20 years later. Oh, that's right. That was the one with, what's his name? Josh Hartnett.
Okay.
With daughter Jamie Lee. Lee had requested that all donations in her name be made to the Motion Picture and Television Foundation, with which she had been actively involved. Lee's publicist, John Fraser, said the actress served on the board of directors for the fund, which provides health care and medical treatment to those who work in the entertainment industry. She was not only a legendary actress, but she was also an author and a humanitarian, Fraser said. Nobody didn't like Janet Leigh, especially when she got slashed there. She was very famous for that movie, and she was in it for about how many minutes? For how many seconds?
About 30, man.
Yeah. She went to the Bates Motel, and that was the end of her. Anyway, so Janet Leigh is dead. We're not going to put her on our poll list today because she's going to get lots and lots. She was just there on CNN just now. We're going to talk about it every day just to make sure you don't forget. Okay, here's the poll result from on Friday. What's your take on the first presidential debate? 3,050 votes. Kerry won big, 1,978, 64.8%. Kerry won by a bit, 316. That's 10.3. You put those two together, you got over 75%. And actually, that's not one of the better. CNN did another instant poll online, Wolf Blitzkrieg, yesterday or over the weekend. You know what the result was?
I give up.
Kerry 93%, Bush 7.
Commies.
You see the bandwagon effect, the way it works?
Good.
In other words, the people are too stupid to figure out who really won and who is coherent and who is actually articulate. Everybody else is Kerry won, so they must be right, which of course they are. But I mean, it's amazing. Anyway, I didn't watch 179, 5.8%. The format made it useless, 165, 5.4%, which is totally wrong. They both sucked, 126, 4.1% of sour negative, those people. Bush won big, 95, 3.1% of people who are on heavy hallucinogens. I don't give a Schmidt, 87, 2.8%. Bush won by a bit. Sure he did, 54, 1.7%. So you add the Kerry numbers together, you got more than 75%, and you got the Bush numbers together, you got 4.8%. Pretty close. Just kind of like the Dolphin-Patriot game will be next Sunday. And it was a draw, only 51.6%. We're stupid enough to say it was a draw. They probably couldn't even draw a picture of it. Now, let's see. We can actually do things in order today. How do you like that? We're not, like, so stressed and pressed for time.
Right.
Like we usually are. In fact, look at that schedule we got today. Mad Dog at 2. The Humper's back at 4. From his exploits in New York with a horse racing and plunging his guts out. Geldy, who's on the payroll, so we might as well make him do something. He's doing a show at Smoky Bones at 7 tonight. The old Geldmeister, followed by Eddie K at 10. So I guess we got the big on some days, certain days, and then we got on other days in that 7 o'clock slot as they try to like make him work for a supper. Jacqueline Lavelle is on our beaded curtain today. Or is it Lovell?
I have no idea, really.
Really?
So your guess.
I think it's Lovell. Jacqueline, I'll level with you. I'll level with you, Lovell.
Lovell with me?
She was born December 9th, 1974, which makes her...
About 30, man.
In December. In Beverly Hills, let's see, she's been in The Pink Panther 2005, post-production, Miss Congeniality, also it still hasn't come out. She was in Rod Steele 0014, You Only Live Until You Die, Click the Body Beautiful, Women of the Night, a lot of freaky auditions from Beyond, Channel Island Girls, Wild Desire, The Killer Eye, The Black Sea. She's also known as Sarah St. James, and also known as Andy McPherson. She goes by a lot of names.
Yeah, she does a lot of things.
The Killer Sea, Black Sea 213, The Key to Sex, Place Called Truth, Freshman Class, Captured on Camera, Click, rhymes with Bic, Girls of Surrender Cinema, Hideous, I'm Watching You, Lolita 2000, Sex, Lies, and Politics. Just so many in here. It's just Exotic House of Wax. Huh?
Yeah, she's waxing.
She was in the Nude Bowling Party. And then there's actually one here that I can't read the name of on the air. Oh, no, she was a football fan in Forrest Gump. Did you know that?
No.
How do you like that? You learn something every day. So she was all over the place. There she is, Jacqueline Lovell. Pretty nice picture there, pretty amazing.
Yeah, she's blowing you a kiss.
Yes, she really is. At any rate, just moving right along. Here's, and more bad news from Iraq. I just mentioned this in passing. We got to do both breaks, right, this half hour? Yes. Please say yes.
Yes.
Okay. Are you eating already?
Yes.
What?
Cuban sandwich from Howie's.
Oh. Thanks to Howie's.
Thank
we
you,
love
Howie's
profusely there on 441 there. Somewhere there. What's the address? Don't worry about it.
2430 South State Road 7.
Howie's is great. The best bacon in town, the best all kinds of good stuff. Bomb blasts leave more dead in Baghdad. How do you like that?
Oh, my God.
Two bomb blasts shook central Baghdad today already, killing at least 14 people, wounding 90 more, while U.S. and Iraqi forces pursue their offensive against rebel strongholds elsewhere in the country. I'll be damned. Thought that El Presidente told us things are going just fine.
Oh, we're fine.
In Iraq. Everything was under control. They're going to have those wonderful free democratic elections in January. It's going to be great. 18 till 11 at 560 WQAM. Guaranteed mortgage bankers are prepared to help you meet all your financing needs. If you're a first-time home buyer or if you're refinancing and taking cash out, they're your best choice by far. Guaranteed mortgage bankers are committed to excellent customer service. It's not only their promise, it is their guarantee to you. Call them today, toll-free at 1-800-734-6616. Because at Guaranteed Mortgage Bankers, their goal is to build a lifelong relationship with their customers, which is exactly what they did with a couple who moved here from New Jersey, hadn't started their new jobs yet, but found a house they fell in love with. Now, the couple hadn't been in South Florida more than a week. They had very little money to put down, wanted to close in just 10 days. And guess what? Guaranteed Mortgage Brokers was able to secure the buyer's needs in order to close on time. They were able to give them 95% financing at the unbelievable rate.
Unbelievable.
Of 5.95%. And listen to this. Guaranteed Mortgage Bankers sends all of their clients on a fabulous seven-night cruise, which is their way of saying thank you for choosing them. Guaranteed Mortgage Bankers. No loans are too big or too small, whether you have bad credit, good credit, or the worst, whatever. They'll work with you to get you the loan you need. Guaranteed Mortgage Bankers. Call them today, 1-800-734-6616. That's 1-800-734-6616.
The Howard Stern Show. Neil Rogers, mornings and midday. And sports around the clock. 560 QAM.
No.
Dolphin Denny is a dork. Oh!
Welcome to another hilarious episode of George Bush Theater.
They think you're like Rain Man. Without the masculine.
George plays Rain Man.
Raymond, what were you doing in my room?
I believe...
Raymond, what were you doing in my room?
I don't know.
You don't know what you were doing in my room.
And...
There were noises. Well, those noises are none of your business. You understand that?
I understand now.
Huh? Put the phone book down, stop acting like an idiot, and go to sleep. Go to sleep!
Stay tuned for the next George Bush Theater, where George plays Forrest Gump.
Go to lunch, George. 1048 at 560 WQM. Here's our poll today. We need some help with this one because they only put three names on there to start, but just to get the thing going. Who best fits this description? A celebrity whose death was least noted.
Okay.
We got Carol O'Connor. Let's see what we got. We got some votes on there already. 8 for Carol O'Connor, 5 for Marlon Brando, and 1 for Celia Cruz.
Incredible.
Huh? I mean, wouldn't you have thought that there would be a national day of mourning for Celia Cruz?
Practically was.
Carol O'Connor, I mean, he just, I'm sorry, but there used to be when somebody famous died, it was like, you know, they went on and on day after day, and it was like a big deal. At least you honored the memory of what the hell they did, you know?
Well, it depends on who it is. Like Bob Hope, I think they're still carrying on.
Well, he sure ain't going to qualify for this poll.
No, exactly.
God, talk about much ado about nothing.
Uh-huh.
At any rate, so that's the poll question. Plus, like I said, if you want to, like, vent about the Dolphins, you know, Clarence, it'll make him happy. If you want to bitch and bellyache, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? Pretty sad. Anyway, that debate victory by John Kerry has really turned the old ass around.
Wrecked him.
That's right. With a solid majority of voters concluding that John Kerry outperformed W in the first presidential debate on Thursday, the president's lead in the race for the White House has evaporated. According to the latest Newsweek poll, Kerry's got 47%, 45 for Bush. I notice now it's 49-46, as they did more polling over the weekend. Now he's 3 points ahead. How do you like that?
I like it.
Mm-hmm.
There goes the spaceship.
Well, now, why do we care about that? It's a money thing. It's a contest.
Right. That's why.
Well, what the hell is that all about? I thought that this was like more exploration of space for good altruistic purposes. This is a freaking contest to see how this guy can get some millions of dollars.
Right.
What kind of baloney is that?
Well, then we can all take a ride on it.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, you first.
Okay.
And even, yeah, you really need some doggy downers. Get a hold of your pill man, will you please? You are just out of control, man. And where was the coffee from you were drinking? Oh, from the...
BP right here in the corner.
BP on the corner, man. They put the P in BP.
Free coffee this morning. I just stopped there for gas.
They had free coffee?
Yeah. Guy was walking around saying, hey, would you like some free coffee? Here's it, and they give you the big cup.
Oh, we
get you some, and I did. Boy, did I get some.
President Bush and John Kerry are about even in the latest poll by the right-wing CNN USA Gallup poll released yesterday. The poll shows Kerry and Bush tied at 49% each among likely voters. Among registered voters, Bush 49, Kerry 47, and Ralph Nader's down to like less than 1%, because nobody with an IQ larger than 3 is, and today's the last day to register to vote, by the way. We should mention that, shouldn't we?
Yes, you should.
And the good news is that in the swing states, including Florida, there's been a last-minute surge. I mean, zillions of people are registering to vote because they realize that they better get with it, right?
Right.
It's interesting, in the Gallup poll taken before the debate, Bush was 8 points ahead. 8 points ahead. And now all of a sudden it's even, Stephen, because America finally had a chance to look at boom, 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 like that. And that was supposed to be on a strong suit on foreign policy,
right,
on fighting terrorism and the war in Iraq and all of these other things, you know?
All of these things.
Now, this Friday when they have the debate on domestic issues like the economy and stem cell research and the woman's right to choose, all of these things, it's really going to be Desperado. And, of course, tomorrow night, John Edwards, whatever the hell his name is, see, you got me doing it.
Careful.
John Edwards is going to slice up Dick Cheney tomorrow. He's just going to, all he's going to do is say Halliburton the whole time. Just going to keep repeating it over and over again. Okay, let's get some more names for this poll. Plus, as I said, oh yeah, here's the deal. A record surge of potential new voters has swamped boards of election from Pennsylvania to Oregon as the biggest of the crucial swing states reach registration deadlines today. And the Michael Moore DVD, Fahrenheit 9/11, comes out tomorrow. Yeah, October 5th is tomorrow, Robin. Elections officials have added staff and equipment, push well beyond budgets and work around the clock to process the registrations. Remember that song by Bill Haley in the comments, Work Around the Clock?
Nope.
In Montgomery County, Pennsylvania, the election staff has been working nights and weekends since the week before Labor Day to process the crush of registrations. Today's the deadline for registering new voters in Pennsylvania, Ohio, Michigan, Florida, and 12 other states, as election workers will go on mandatory overtime to chip away at the thousands of forms that have been arriving daily. They're pouring in. The vote was so close 4 years ago, people are now thinking, hey, maybe my vote might count, said Joseph Passarella, Director of Voter Services in Montgomery County. Al Gore won Pennsylvania by 205,000 votes in 2000. And officials across the country report similar patterns. Everything we're seeing is that there's been a tremendous increase in voter registration, said Kay Maxwell, President of the League of Women Voters. And the reason being that there's a tremendous disenchantment in the land, if you catch my drift. People are fired up and pissed off. WQAM, hello.
Hi, I'm in West Palm. I've been getting a Spanish language station in the background with you guys for the last few days. Do you know anything about it?
No, I don't. You mean Fidel has cranked up one of those stations to interfere with us now? Is that it?
I don't know. I mean,
sounds like a commie pinko plot to me.
You haven't heard that from anybody else?
Not yet.
I noticed it like Thursday or Friday during Hank's show.
Right.
And I thought it was just a temporary little situation, and then it's still doing it.
Oh,
I mean,
boy.
I hear Spanish music while makes it kind of tough to listen because it's really annoying.
Wow. Probably Cheap Channel cranked up something on our frequency.
Hmm.
Well, thanks for the bad news.
All right, sorry.
And okay. Say goodbye to Teresa Lepore for us.
Okay, we will.
Thanks.
Bye.
So how do you like that? There you go again. Just when we think we got everything going right, Fidel cranks up one of those stations. Remember when I was at WNWS 100 years ago, we had the same problem. He cranked up one of those 80 zillion watt. You know, that's pretty interesting. Didn't I just have a story the other day about the electricity shortage on the island down there?
Yes, indeed. Although you made a joke about Clear Channel, but you know they've got a lot of Spanish language stations now, as you know.
Yeah, that could be. Maybe they're interfering intentionally to try to, like, knock us down. Ain't going to work, okay? David Ross, Petey Bulger, Rada Wolf, Fink.
Not that they would do anything like that.
No, they sure wouldn't. They're too ethical, as we know. WQAM, hello.
What up, Greg?
What was it?
Sorry. I was hoping you were going to tell me.
No, I thought you were going to interpret for me. Maybe it was in Espanol. Maybe he's the guy that's got cranked it up. Maybe he's the crank. WQAM, hello.
Hi, Neil. How are you?
Okay, sir.
Something that I actually don't think anybody has raised in the debate, if I may, was Bush's insistence on multilateral talks with Korea. And I was wondering that if that was such a failure with Iraq, why was it so important to do that with Korea? And why was it such a stupid idea to do one-on-one? Like, you know, this is completely inconsistent with one part of the world versus another. And I wonder if...
Hey, listen, he's under a lot of pressure, man. Just rely. Just leave, cut him some slack. He's under a lot of stress. Now that he knows he's going to lose.
Anybody comment on that? Because it was really a hallmark of his Korea policy to pursue multilateral. And he's completely rejected that elsewhere in the world.
Well, he's feeling a little eel these days. Okay, thanks, Pally. We don't want to, like, do light bulb radio here today, please. 5670560, pound 560 on the Verizon and Singular Wireless lines. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, you do.
What do you say?
WQAM, hello.
And the Dolphins are in the loss column.
Thanks, Joe. WQAM, hello.
Neil?
Always like that, Joe Angel. Yes, sir.
Hey, Neil, how you doing today?
All right.
Aren't these Dolphins a joke, man? This is something to laugh about. I got one request from you.
Yeah.
Do you think you could play the Dolphin song for me?
No problem.
Thanks a lot.
Well, you knew that was coming anyway. I mean,
yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
I mean, you knew that was coming. I just, I don't understand these people.
Which Dolphin song, though?
The Dolphin, the only one that we, oh, I got new. Let's play the real one. What do you say,
there
huh?
You go.
That ought to be good for some laughs. Here we go.
Miami has a Dolphin, the greatest football team. We take the ball from goal to goal.
Yeah, that's enough of that crap. They're an embarrassment, they're humiliating, they're degrading, they're pathetic would be an understatement, and yet they seem to be like frozen. You know what I mean? Like they're in, Wayne is in suspended animation. He don't know whether to Schmidt or eat 40 bananas. He don't know what to do. And even a casual observer, even George that despises the whole deal, could have told you before the season that they got no quarterback, that they were going to stink like crazy, that their coach was a joke, the Wanstead era was a nightmare. Yeah. Even you could have told them that.
That's right.
Had and there's Wayne there's Wayne like picking the pockmarks out of his puss or whatever he's doing. Man, it is sad. 10:56 at 5:60. Well, of course, some people think it's sad. Some of us think it's okay when you come right down to it. Hey, I've been telling you for a long time why you need to shop at 1-800-MATTRESS when the old mattress is worn out, and I want to tell you even more. Battle Mattress is proud to carry right now Sealy Posturepedic, the number one branded mattresses. Call 1-800-MATTRESS today and you'll get factory direct prices on all Sealy Posturepedics. When you call 1-800-MATTRESS, you'll get same-day delivery all across town. By calling 1-800-MATTRESS, you choose from the deepest and widest selection of Sealy bedding, all available for same-day delivery. And as always, you still get to pick the date and time, that two-hour window for delivery to fit your schedule. And don't forget, Dial a Mattress shows up on time 99.7% of the time. Dial a Mattress, they're ranked number one in customer satisfaction. They were winners of the 2004 Better Business Bureau Local Torch of Excellence Award. All the smart folks and even the mediocre ones are making that call because they know they can waste a lot of gas, time, and effort schlepping to the bedding and department stores to get ripped off. Or the other alternative is just to sit there on their fat ass and make the one easy call. The smartest piece of shopping you'll ever do, just call 1-800-MATTRESS. They'll be knocking on your door in no time at all. Check them on the web if you like mattress.com. But please, make that phone call. You'll never go bed shopping again in those bedding and department stores. 1-800-MATTRESS, 1-800-MATTRESS.
You're listening to Neil Rogers, exclusively on 560 QAM. Rogers.
God. Oh, my God.
I'm dying out of here.
Miami has the Dolphins. They're the worst football team. They flub the ball from goal to goal like no one's ever seen. They're on the ground. That's where they'll stay. They're never in control. And when you say Miami, you're talking toilet bowl, because they're the Miami Dolphins. Miami Dolphins. Miami Dolphins number, how many teams in the league?
32.
Miami Dolphins, Miami Dolphins, don't bet on them, you'll always lose. They don't know how to tackle, they don't know how to block. Their coaches ought to tell them to put Bengay in their jock. Then they would run much faster, and even in defeat, when we go to the stadium, we'll see Miami Heat. And they're the Miami Dolphins, Miami Dolphins, Miami Dolphins number. How many teams in the league?
32.
Miami Dolphins, Miami Dolphins, the team that hasn't got a clue. Miami has the Dolphins, but the Dolphins have no fans. Just 50,000 apples sitting in the stands. They watch the game and all they do is moan and gripe and bitch. I wonder how Joe Robbie got to be so damn rich. And they're the Miami Dolphins.
Oh!
Miami Dolphins. Miami Dolphins number. How many teams in the league?
About 30, man.
Miami Dolphins. Miami Dolphins. I hear the crowd begin to boo.
Losers!
The Dolphins have Jay Fiedler, that quarterback's a Jew. Run down the field and he will throw a pass over you.
Oy!
He'll never win a Super Bowl, you shouldn't be surprised. When he gets cut, that doesn't mean that he was circumcised. And they're the Miami Dolphins, Miami Dolphins, Miami Dolphins number. How many teams in the league?
32.
Miami Dolphins, Miami Dolphins. Jay calls his signals in Hebrew.
Are you sure?
The Dolphins have no defense and their offense is a joke. Like George Bush eating pretzels, you know they're gonna choke. They'll always disappoint you when they're in a playoff race. With fewer points than pockmarks on Huizenga's ugly face. And they're the Miami Dolphins, Miami Dolphins, Miami Dolphins number, oh what the hell, 32. Miami Dolphins, Miami Dolphins, Miami Dolphins, now they're through.
I'm dying over here.
Oh! 1104-560-WQM, happy Monday to you. Don't get all bent out of shape, okay? Get used to it. What's wrong with a perfect season? Not everybody can do that. Right? I'm thinking at 16. I thought myself that Arizona might be the choice on their schedule, somebody they might be able to beat. And Arizona whipped New Orleans. What was it, 34-10? By the way, I made a mistake, and Josh Corder should have corrected me. The Dolphins, I left the field goal out. They've scored 32 points, not 29. It was 32 is what they've scored in four games. So that's 8 points a game on average.
Well, that's the big time.
Right. That's a touchdown, and there really is no way to get the other point, but a touchdown and another extra point. Well, they could go, like, for two, right?
Right, every game.
A touchdown and a two-pointer every game. Just because they know that they're not going to get no more chances. That's really pathetic. The once proud and mighty franchise has been turned to pure instant caca. Hal Wannstedt is still there. Just beats the hell out of me. He's just hopeless. Put together a real dog of a team. But nevertheless, I don't want to dwell on that. It'll make Clarence happy, though. We got to get some other names for this poll, for this list. These people are not going to like do Dolphins for 4 hours like Clarence wanted, that little sports nerd. Who best fits this description? A celebrity whose death was least noted. We did the least shrying and crying when they died. So far, all we got is the three names that I put on there because all these other people want to talk about you-know-what. 70 votes, Carol O'Connor, 44, Marlon Brando, 15, and Celia Cruz, only 11 for poor Celia.
Well, let's put the
look at that.
On the
Spaceship One succeeds in second X-Prize flight. Aren't you excited about that or what?
Yeah.
Huh? Yeah, big deal. Line 9, QAM, hello.
Phil Hartman.
Phil Very Hartman, good. That's
Very
a good one. Good
Very
choice.
Good.
Thank you.
Love you.
Okay. No, that's a good choice.
That's an excellent choice. I want to change my vote.
We love Phil Hartman
yes,
on this
did.
Show, and damn.
Crazy bitch.
Yeah, too bad that she didn't let us do it.
Crazy coked up whore.
I'm sure that we got, we do.
Goodbye, Phil Hartman. Brinded you in, and you were a real good guy that had so much more to give. But you married a psychotic bitch. A trigger finger got an itch. But the good news is that she blew herself away. Cause everybody knows that in L.A. they let murderers walk every day. And now the laughter has died thanks to your psycho bitch wife who had a stupid name like
Rin.
And news radio was a lame show except that you were there. And some characters from The Simpsons had lost their voice. If not for that bitch, your life would have lasted long. But she left you no choice. Goodbye, Troy McClure, that you may know from such films as I Married an Ex-Murderer, Mom Has a Gun, and Honey, I Just Blew Your Head Off. Now Lionel Hutz can't get Bryn off. She's dead anyway, and Saturday Night has fallen further in decay since that's the reason you left anyway. And it sucks that you die because of your psychotic wife.
with that stupid name like Brit. And the Simpsons will never be the same again. And assholes like Chuck Heston preach a false sunrise. It's a good thing she's dead, cause now they can't defend that bitch you had for a while.
You know, we really have to do something about all these words that we have to keep deleting here. It's unacceptable is what it is. You know, it is unacceptable.
Unacceptable, yeah.
Every bit that I play, it's, right. You know, we got to dump something in there because some hole comes in there or like damn or, you know.
Innocuous
we've been playing
things.
These things for how many years now?
About 30, man.
Oh, yeah. Well, Joyce says you can't do this and you can't say that. We're peeing in our pants. That's why we put on Howard Stern because we're so scared. I just... Somewhere there's, like, inconsistency in there, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I just don't get it. But moving right along, WQAM, hello.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
Did you discuss what Judge Scalia said last week?
About?
He was at a speech. And...
Yeah, about, you're talking about orgies?
Yeah.
Yeah, we had the story, yeah, thanks. WQAM, hello.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Neil.
Yes.
How about Bon Imus?
Very good.
That was the best.
Imus is so boring.
What's better than a live radio show every morning on TV? Well, just about anything. But that hasn't stopped MSNBC from teaming up with radio's original bad boy, who now looks like a nasty old lady.
Listen, Bernie.
Imus.
Tell that intern this copy sucks.
Yes, every morning, see Imus listen to a tape of other people's comedy bits, live on the air.
I need a hammer to bite into this muffin. You somebody get me a fresh one, please? Thank you.
See his wild behind-the-scenes antics.
Hey, listen to me, stupid. I am the I-Man. You are the walrus cuckoo-ca-choo. Now get me some fresh copy or you're fired.
Imus, he's irreverent.
So what's the deal with the Pope?
He's topical.
So what's the deal with this Watergate break?
He's incoherent.
I'll tell you what, that is a double president? What the hell is it? I don't know.
He's
Imus and he's boring.
And he's only on MSNBC, a cable channel nobody watches, and a bunch of AM radio stations nobody listens to.
Yeah, but somebody get some fresh jingle.
It's Imus.
A dead man in a chair, man. He the best. And I'll tell you, I don't know who's the most annoying, whether it's Brother Fred on the ranch or whether it's a Bo Diddley Deedle. Same crap over
Deedle,
and
man.
Over and over again. It's just, wouldn't you think I would all the, and what's her name? Bernadette Castro.
Oh, President Bush is going to win. President Bush is going to win. President Bush is going to win.
Over your dead body, Bernadette. How do you like that, bitch?
Ooh.
Hater. WQAM, hello.
You know what I hope John Edwards does in the debates with Cheney is that they've been attacking Kerry for intelligence cuts and defense cuts during the early and mid-90s. Dick Cheney, when he was Secretary of Defense, was calling for a 30% spending in defense.
About 30, man.
Yeah, by 1996 because of the peace dividend, and the Cold War was over, and Cheney was saying when the Democrats controlled Congress, when he was Secretary of Defense, he was complaining about all the military spending and the F-14s and the B-2 bombers they didn't need. And now this same clown, this chrome dome clown, is attacking Kerry for cutting defense, and he was calling for even bigger cuts than John Kerry.
Just wait, Pally. Edwards is going to slice him to smithereens tomorrow.
He has to, man, because Kerry kind of he didn't go after Bush on certain things, most notably that $87 billion. When Kerry did vote for it, the first bill, and all the Republicans in the Senate except one voted against the first bill for the $87 billion.
Yeah, but don't forget, when you only have a 30-second rebuttal, how much are you going to say? You know, I thought he gave a really good answer about how he may have misspoken about his vote. He made a mistake on how he spoke about the war, but Bush is the one who started it and invaded Iraq. What's worse? That was a good line.
Bush rushing to war is further proof that he sent them there without the body armor to begin with.
Well, he covered that. He did a good job on that.
All right, Neil.
Have a great day, Pally. Calm down a little bit. A little bit too hyper for a Monday now. I realize the Dolphins lost. And in addition to which, Kerry, I mean, look at all the ground he made up with the one debate. Just in the one debate. It was a complete turnaround.
Wrecked him.
In just a couple of days. So it goes to show you, there are a few people out there that got an IQ larger than their toenail.
About 30, man.
Right. Things are starting to turn a little bit as the worm squirms. And this guy won $10 million for this, the X Prize after his second flight. Well, whoop-de-doo. Aren't you excited about that?
Yeah, I am.
Did he cure cancer?
No.
Did he cure, like, leukemia?
No.
Or all these things?
No.
More important than that.
Oh, I see.
Way off this berg.
He went up real high and real fast.
Uh-huh.
Well, if you want to get up real high and get real high real fast, just go to the BP, I guess, get some of that free coffee.
Oh, man.
11:13 at 560 QAM. Do you want to know more about following a low-carb diet? Do you want the best-tasting, largest selection of delicious low-carb foods at the best price? Then here's the story you're going to fall in love with, the Lights of West Boca. whether you're starting or restarting any of the low-carb diets, the Atkins, the Sugar Busters, the South Beach, any of these. Delights of West Boca continues to be the number one low-carb store in the entire South Florida area. We know that you can shop at your local grocery store, but if you want a better selection, if you want to be able to try, sample anything in the store before you buy it, and if you want to do business with people that understand low-carb dieting inside and out, this is the place you're going to love shopping. Like I said, Delights of West Boca, your low-carb headquarters. You'll find over 1,200 great products like Carbolite ice cream, breads, pasta, chocolates, brownies, cookies, and lots more. Delights is open every day, 7 days a week from 10 to 10. You'll find them on the northeast corner of Glades and 441 right next to Boston Market. Or call them toll-free at 1-877-LOW-CARB, L-O-W-C-A-R-B, or on the web, lowcarb.com. Don't forget, there's only one, but what a store it is. Delights of West Boca, your official Atkins Retail Center.
You are listening to Neil Rogers, exclusively on 560 QAM.
A stench of cow manure hovers over this performance by the Dolphins.
Lemon, yellow, orange, yellow, gas, X, X, Lax, you, bro, Duke, Lax, Simon, Tap, Destin, X, Laura, Mendo, Wanda, LaShonda, LASIK, Claritin, Formica, Dexatrim, Lanolin, Fluorescent, Cavesty, Ovaltine, Dramamine, Benzene, Abosheen, Leticia, Feldine, Pine, Doll, Liquid, Queen, and Histamine, Booby, Lips, Ricola, Aspler, Gum, Metamucil, Enema, and Valerium, Mambo, Balambo, Shaka, Laka, Lanacane, Camel, Ophanine, Dairy, Ease, and Rogaine, Gotcha, Got It, Sorbitol, Dussy, and Tylenol.
What's with the names that they be giving to the black kids? Do they think it's Mo-Afro?
Uh-huh.
You look for names at the drugstore.
Yeah. Euphora, Ladoya, Vendora, Creamora, Sensen, Buffering, Deadman, etc. Robidozin, Yoplait, Triamenic, Musilix, Low Dose, Bebo, Bromo, Seltzer, Sucrets, Kynolotion, Motrin, Raisinet, Tagamet, Playtex, Malcomex, Tic Tac, Epicat, Nitom, Alanta, Cetacol, and Geritol, Psoriasis, Latifa, Setoria, Nyquil, Triamenic, Vicks, Pfizer, Dermasheed, and Vagisil, Syphilis, and Gonorrhea, Neutrogena, and Moesha.
What's with the names that they be giving to the black kids? Do they think it's Mo-Afro? Beautiful names at the drugstore. Yo, 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 yo. Why do they think it's black to give their kids those dumb names? With all the names that they'll find in at the corner of Walgreens.
My favorite... something fancy. My favorite one of all, well, I didn't want to step on it, is Plexico Burris, the Pittsburgh Steelers. Plexico.
Plexico?
Yeah. You know where he gets his gas?
No.
Plexico. I mean, what is that? Plexico Burris. What kind of a name is that? I mean, I am hip or X-ray hip or IB hip or whatever that one. That was pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
But Plexico, I mean, give me a break. Cracker, please. 567-0560, pound 560 on the Verizon and Singular Wireless line. See, Phil Hartman, that was exactly...
Right.
That was perfect. That was so good, it was scary.
Indeed.
Because that is the definitive kind of answer for the poll we're asking. Which, who best fits this description? A celebrity whose death was least noted. In other words, they died and, like, you know, nobody even paid any attention. They didn't give a big song to dance like Bob freaking Hope. WQAM, hello.
Jan Perry and Frankie Lyman. Put them both on there.
Well, I guess better.
We're not putting no Frankie Lyman. Jan Berry's a good one, though, from Jan and Dean. They sang off-key real well for a long time, all of them surfing songs.
Mm-hmm.
Ripped off all of Brian Wilson's music. Jan Berry, I like that. Now, wasn't he, see, I get them confused. Wasn't he the one that was like kind of a vegetable after that Corvette wreck years ago?
I don't know.
Yeah, he was. You better get your Jan and Dean straightened out, mister. The Bridgestone is going to come near your ass. WQAM, hello.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'm going to go with John Candy.
So there's another excellent one. Perfect. Thanks, Pally. John Candy. Too much candy for John.
Mm-hmm.
He was nobody. You know, he was Canadian, eh?
That's right.
Did you know that?
Of course, SCTV. All the SCTV guys are.
I think we're going to do that tomorrow. I like that poll. Your favorite Canadian celebrity of all time.
Performer, celebrity, any kind?
Right, anybody.
Right.
Singer, musician, right, besides Anne Marie and Celine Dion.
Right.
Hey, listen, nobody's perfect, eh? Look, we got under a lot of stress. We got no hockey going on. Damn it. Leafs TV's got a lot of fishing shows on there now. And, by the way, I can mention now, it just dawned on me, because I see that Denise Potvin is hosting on the Fox Sports or whatever the hell it is. Instead of the Panther games, which there aren't any, he's hosting this thing where they're showing the greatest games of Panther history, Denise Potvin. Well, now that Rimmer's in Columbus and safely escaped from a Denise, I want the whole world to know how much Rimmer hated him like poison and wishes something evil would happen to a Potvin. I'm just passing that along. Couldn't say it all these years, you know. But now I can safely say that. Hey, Denise, you dumb frog. Rimmer hates you like poison. Wishes that somebody would poison your smoked meat. WQAM, hello.
Hey there.
How you doing?
Just fine. I want to put the real Mo Howard on the pole.
Oh, the real Mo Howard.
The real one.
Okay, as opposed to...
Exactly. And also, we're in the Redlands, and we're getting the Spanish radio feedback on our radio, too.
Oh, no, on 560, huh?
Yes, sir.
And how bad is it?
Pretty bad.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, how come our astute engineering staff hasn't been aware of this?
Well, I don't know why your astute engineering staff hasn't been aware of it, but I want to make them aware of it.
Unfreaking believable. Well, thanks for the bad news.
Okay, and get rid of Howdy Doody and get Carrie in there.
All right.
Bye.
We're working on it feverishly. Don't forget, today's the last day to register. Don't be screwing around, okay? Get with it. Drag a few dark folks with you while you're at it. So that's the bad news now. This is like Desi Roux all over again.
Yeah.
How about Lucille Ball?
There you go. Well, they made a big deal out of her.
Did they? Yeah, they did. You're right.
Well,
it was a long time ago. She's been dead for
a long time.
Not
that she didn't deserve it, mind you, but...
No, but you're right. I'm just checking. What about Desi Arnaz?
No, there's one that they did not. The inventor of the sitcom, the rerun,
right.
You know it. That three-stage set that he designed, the Babaloo.
What is that? My phone in the other room is ringing off the hook. I picked during the break. I went out there, and there's a message from a place that wanted to cater a Thanksgiving dinner, which I'm not the least bit interested in. You do understand Thanksgiving's next Monday, eh? Canadian Thanksgiving?
Yeah.
And it's starting to get just like Florida now with all these solicited calls and all this other crap going on. The faxes I finally stopped because you have to, it took about 15 different times. What's that? Did you hear that?
No. What?
There are just all kinds of phones.
Weird noises. Speaking of faxes.
Yeah.
From the fax machine, we got Alec Guinness.
That's a good one.
And Ray Charles from John in South Carolina.
Oh, and Ray Charles, my God, they gave that a lick and a schmear, poor Ray.
Sure.
Ray Charles, I mean, what'd I say? Georgia? Ray Charles was so great for so long. And in honor of that, see, we got something in honor of just about anybody. We got...
You know when he's white... You know you can feel it, baby. You know it, hear it. His timing's so white.
He's a honky, uh-huh.
You pick the white one, baby.
He's a honky.
If he's totally white, credible, and Caucasianly dreadable, and ain't got no butterball, you pick the white one, baby.
You got the white one, baby.
You know when he's white, you just got to face it.
You got the white one, baby.
You got the white one. If he's completely fat, burnable, very uncolorful, and laughably fullable, you pick the white one, baby.
You're listening to Neil Rogers on 560 QAM.
Yeah. MONDAYSUCKS.
Things were great.
It's 11:30 at 560 WQM, which used to be able to hear in Dayton Broward, and now evidently, and even in Palm Beach. Isn't that kind of like disconcerting news? Because I've been through this before. And when he cranks up those monsters, man, with like a half a million watts, it just, you know, not that we don't have enough signal problems already. Now, so is anybody, huh?
What are you going to do?
So does anybody come rushing in there saying, oh, gee, we got a signal problem? What's it all about? No.
I'm sorry. I thought that was a rhetorical question.
And fix it hasn't come back in there to fix the fax machine that's been broken down there on your end and the phone line for days and days and days? No?
No.
Oh, brother. What a freaking place, man. Let's have some more meetings. What do you say, okay? We don't want to get anything fixed or get things going or get people their money on time, but let's just have some more meetings.
Alex says, how about John Ritter?
John Ritter's a good choice, even though I couldn't stand John Ritter, but that's right up your alley. I don't know. I thought they made kind of a big timis about that, but it's
made
okay.
Kind of a timis, but nevertheless.
Okay. They should have had like a John Ritter week. Everybody should have had a week off from work, including the Dolphins. They've taken 4 weeks off. When are they going to start? Okay, 158 votes. Poll question. Who bets fits this description? Celebrity whose death was least noted. Carol O'Connor, 72. Marlon Brando, 22. Celia Cruz, 18. Phil Hartman, 17. Mo Howard, the real one, 11. Not any imitators.
Absolutely.
John Candy, 7. Alec Guinness, 5. Jan Berry, 5. Ray Charles, 1. And Desi Arnaz, he's got the big.
Oh!
Come on now. Babalu! Babalu! What's wrong with you people? Enkan no rachmanis. Speaking of that.
Yeah.
You know, why do people call me in the middle of my show when they know that I'm on the air? I mean, how is it possible to be so stupid?
Maybe they don't know.
No, they do know. They should know. I'm talking about, like, my financial advisor guy down there who, like, oh, brother. What is wrong with these people? I'm on the air doing a show, okay, Bill? I'm on till 2 o'clock, like every day, just about. Now that the summer is over, you silly goose, you. Man, I don't understand people.
I don't know.
Fox News pulls reporter's item with fake Kerry quotes. See, this is Fox News for you. Unfair, unbalanced, absolutely
unbelievable.
Fox News apologized Friday for posting phony quotes from Democratic presidential candidate John Kerry on its website. Carl Cameron, a Fox reporter who covers the Kerry campaign, wrote an item that looked like a news story with made-up Kerry quotes, said Paul Scherer, a Fox spokesman. The item was not intended to be posted on the site. Right. Carl made a stupid mistake, which he regrets, Scherer said Friday night, and he's been reprimanded for his lapse in judgment. It was a poor attempt at humor. The phony item posted early Friday read in part, rallying supporters in Tampa Friday, Kerry played up his performance in Thursday night's debate in which many observers agreed the Massachusetts senator outperformed the president. Didn't my nails and cuticles look great? What a good debate, Kerry said Friday. With a foreign policy debate in the history books, Kerry hopes to keep the pressure on and the sense of traction going. All these are made up. Aides say he'll step up attacks on the president in the next few days and pivot somewhat to the domestic agenda with a focus on women and abortion rights. It's about the Supreme Court. Women should like me. I do manicures, Kerry said. The item also quoted Kerry as saying of himself and President Bush, I'm metrosexual. He's a cowboy. After withdrawing the item, Fox posted a statement on its website apologizing for the error. It said the item was based on a reporter's partial script that had been written in jest and should not have been posted or broadcast. We regret the error which occurred because of fatigue and bad judgment, not malice. Oh, certainly there'd be no malice from Fox News.
No.
Cameron has been a political reporter for Fox since 1996. Asked about the incident, Kerry spokesman David Wade said, America would be stronger if only George Bush could admit his mistakes as easily. Well, how do you like that? Here's a thing from MoveOn.org. Do you get this?
I get everything.
So MoveOn PAC members in Sunrise Plantation and Tamarack are invited tomorrow night to cheer on John Edwards as he takes on Dick Cheney. Well, there's a lot of flab there to slice into, about 280 pounds of it, I bet, in the vice presidential debate and learn what we can do on the ground to help beat the Bush-Cheney ticket. Tomorrow night, 8 p.m. at Scott Hodges' house. I don't know if I want to give this out on the air, do I? Well, I don't know why not. At Scott Hodges' house? I mean, I don't know.
I don't know either.
Well, if you're a MoveOn.org person, go to their website. I mean, you're going to get this anyway.
Don't go.
No, I just don't feel comfortable giving out people's addresses and phone numbers.
Yeah.
I mean, even though it's on the web, you know, it's on the MoveOn.org. They're very reputable. Yada. Go to MoveOn.org and read all about it.
Let's
like Johnny in the Philip Morris spots used to say, read all about it. Why did he say that? I'm not really sure I know.
Was he a newspaper boy?
No. Well, he was like holding up a thing of Philip Morris, tastes great, and Lucky Strike means fine tobacco, all of those other things, back when we had cigarette commercials on the air that really were great, really neat.
I got, Book of Brian gave me a DVD of some.
All the Salem and Newport spots with the beautiful young couples, you know, you're going to be glamorous and get laid a lot if you just smoke right. Newports and Salem.
Red Flintstone.
Right. And don't forget to pop his vitamins, too. I want you to with that coffee from BP.
Woo!
I'm really, that thing with it, signal problem again, I'm not prepared to go through all of that over again.
Oh, please.
Oh, please what? I think they're going to have to, like, pay us for just laying out and just let the Spanish thing go. Hey, probably get a 30 share in Miami. WQAM, hello. Not there on line three. Shame on you. You have to be a little bit patient, okay? We got a lot of fish to fry here, baby. And if you talk real nice to us, we might let you have some. We might send you some in a bag or like in a vest like Luca Brasi's. WQAM, hello.
Hey, Neil, how you doing?
Okay.
Yeah, it's Neil, about George Bush. I heard his brother Jeb is even dumber than he is.
Okay, good. Thanks for the good news. I got a bigger ass. WQAM, hello.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
Hey, Eazy-E.
What is it?
Eazy-E. He was a rapper from the West Coast. We used to rap with Dr. Dre, NWA.
Dr. Dre, you're a cup? Yeah.
Stop laughing and start typing, Josh.
Okay, get with it. Eazy-E. Yeah, what's wrong with you, man?
Yo.
Yeah, yo, get with it. What's wrong with you? God almighty, we got some dullards or what? Exactly. 567-0560, pound 560 on the Verizon and Singular Wireless line. They're under a lot of pressure there, don't you understand? The Dolphins are caving in.
Right.
Marlins didn't make the playoffs. The Panthers aren't playing at all.
Well,
must be the pressure all
coffee.
Them hockey fans down there. Yeah. God almighty. Life, and of course, right on the heels of all that hurricane stuff, man, it just never lets up, does it? The crap just keeps on coming. WQAM, hello.
For some of us.
Yeah,
hey, Dana, what's the Dolphin tickets for the station? You want them back?
Now that's bad. Yeah, wait till we have the next Dolphin ticket giveaway thing, okay? The only thing that's going to get scalped is the guy, whoever's giving it away. That is a joke. Anybody want to? And it looked to me like a whole bunch, like thousands of people disguised as empty orange seats in the PP Park yesterday. I watched most of that game, I got to be honest.
They were wearing team-colored ponchos.
See, one thing about the Patriots, I mean, we didn't play very good yesterday. We were off our feed for darn sure. Even Tommy Brady was a little bit off his game. But nevertheless, still kicked some Buffalo ass down there in Orchard Park. See, when you're not playing your best, and you can still escape with a pretty convincing victory. And when Drew Bledsoe was doing his best Jay Fiedler imitation, fumbling the ball, putting it on the ground, you know, we were okay. And then you watch that Dolphin game afterward, and you think, holy cow, this is unbelievable. Freaking unacceptable is what it is. And I fully expected to check on a website this morning, Sun Sentinel, Miami Herald. Dave wants that fired. Wayne promises total reorganization. I think we just need to bring Danny Boy back.
Oh!
Yeah. Just make him the figurehead. Oh, look at that, a book about Judge Clarence Token Thomas. Do you see that?
Chat a little bit. Yeah. Both surprised that the issue of who would be the next president isn't coming.
Oh, man. Yeah, I don't understand why they're not talking about that. That's a good point, finally, that you made after all these years, is that the next president's going to pick probably three Supreme Court justices, and the whole balance of what's going to happen on these Supremes. If they got Bush in there again another 4 years, you're not going to have any more Roe versus Wade. Nobody's going to have any rights except rich fundamentalist white folks, and that's going to be the end of America as you used to know it. That'll be it.
Mm-hmm.
Not that I want to get you nervous. Don't forget, today's the last day to register to vote. WQAM, hello.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
Two comments.
Yes.
On the poll, Chris Farley and... It would be great to see the Dolphins wearing some pink tutus because they play like a bunch of pansies.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Goodbye, Chris Farley. You great big fatty. Always acting like a great big fat dumb retard in every film you've ever made. Too bad for David Spade. His career could fade, cause all he has left is that lame-o TV show. He won't be making muddy movies no more. And you wanted to be just like John Belushi and have John Candy's chins. You finally made it, but were not too careful what you wished. You gave us lots of laughter on Saturday night. But you were way too young to die, to commit Batman suicide.
I'm dying over here.
Goodbye, Chris Farley. What did you eat to blow up like a big balloon, eating like a fool? That would only bring you certain death. The farmers are upset, and all you left was some cable movies and a few pairs of your pants that will fill to make community pools. And you wanted to be just like John Belushi and have John Candy's chins. You finally made it, but we're not too careful what you wish. Your casket could hold a piano that's 6 feet wide. Now you've reached the pizza in the sky. You got so fat you died.
I'm dying over here.
You're listening to Neil Rogers exclusively on 560.
Yank it, baby.
Okay.
Hey, there we go. Hey, y'all, my name is Clarence Eugene Thomas, President Bush's nominee for the Supreme Court. And you know, there's lots of people out there that think just because I smoked a little marijuana when I was in college, hell, it wasn't nothing but a pen joint. Hell, maybe a cigar side joint. I don't remember y'all. That they don't think I'm fit to be on the Supreme Court. Hey, I got the munchies. Let's do this quick and get out of here. I want to set y'all straight. When I start reviewing the law, I don't just review the law. Hell, y'all, I be toking. And I toke it to the east, and I toke it to the west.
Oh.
And I toke it while I look up Sandra Day O'Connor's dress.
Oh, right.
I be toking. Let's go burn one, y'all.
11:45 at 560 WQM. I must be so psychic that I ought to be doing my own Schvo Griffin show.
Yeah, we do.
What was
that.
I just talking about a few minutes ago about telemarketers and about these pain in the ass calls and it's getting as bad, you know, and then it turns out it wasn't a telemarketer at any rate, it was somebody who should have known better. And just in, only moments ago during the break, the U.S. Supreme Court seems on there that actually makes some sense. See what I'm saying? I didn't know whether people would catch on to what I was talking about, would call in and say, well, how about Albert Einstein, you know, stuff like that. Who best fits the description, celebrity whose death was least noted? Carol O'Connor, 88, that was my vote. Very unfair. Should have had like a week of Carol O'Connor crying and gnashing of teeth, right? All in the family reruns. Well, we already got those. Carol O'Connor, 88. Moe Howard, the real...
Absolutely.
Oh, he died?
Doi.
29. I'm telling you one thing. With those games that he's got to call this year, he's going to be dying. Oh, he was probably rooting for the Jets anyway. Yes, they don't you think?
We know it.
Marlon Brando, 26. We know his family was. Marlon Brando, 26. Phil Hartman, 23. Celia Cruz has got 20. Come on, just a little tiny bit of Celia.
I am Celia Cruz and I am dead now. But I remember when I was alive. I will need to do the little way.
Incredible. Jan Berry, 13, of Jan and Dean fame. Alec Guinness, 10, and the Bridge on the River Kwai. What else did Alec Guinness do? He's best remembered for that, but he was a great actor.
Star Wars, baby.
Oh, yeah. Oh, man. Am I losing it or what? Yeah. Well, I didn't have the coffee like you did. Ray Charles, 9. Well, see, now that shows a generation gap right there. That's probably the Echo Boomers that are thinking Star Wars.
But I watched both of them, so there you go.
Right. Ray Charles, 9. John Candy, 9. Eazy-E. All right, 3. 3 for Eazy-E. Desi Arnaz has got 3. And Chris Farley and John Ritter both have so far the big.
Oh!
Yeah. I mean, John Ritter, I think they went overboard. I don't even know why I let that go on there, but that's okay. 233 vote.
I didn't like him either, but apparently he was a very nice guy.
Was he really? Where'd you
hear
that?
Everybody said. Everybody that worked with
him. Oh, I got one for you.
Yeah.
Even though you're not going to agree.
Yeah.
Just having watched his biography again the other night on the Biography Channel, Dave Thomas.
Why wouldn't I agree?
Well, I don't know, because there was a big hoopla about that for like an hour after he died. You know, Tony Cigaretto said this, and a lot of people in South Florida said great things because he was a great guy.
Yes, he was.
But I mean, Dave Thomas was an institution. He wasn't just a Wendy spokesman. He was like one of the biggest commercial spokesmen.
No argument from me.
Right. Dave Thomas, and then you can put Wendy's in parentheses so they know who we're talking about, because a lot of people, you know, they would recognize his fat face there on TV.
Right.
You see that quadruple bypass, that was probably the beginning of the end for Dave, unfortunately.
Gee.
No, well.
Should have been a hint.
Too many of those fatty burgers, man. I love Wendy's, don't get me wrong. I would never knock Wendy's at all, especially when they give you the right order at the window, which is not too common in certain parts of town.
Oh, boy.
But I love Wendy's. Their food is juicy and delicious and fresh, like I said, when it hasn't been sitting around. Did I mention Ruth Chris yet today?
I don't know if you mentioned it on the air.
Not on the air. I told you before the show. I had last night Ruth Chris in the Hilton Hotel downtown Toronto. Probably the best meal I've ever had in my life. And I've eaten at Ruth Chris how many times?
About 30, man.
A lot more than that. That's just the times I've paid for the Rimmers. Oh, by the way, they're not here. What a shame. But anyway, I had Ruth Chris, and I had the best steak, a ribeye without the butter. See, if you're one of those people that's got like a sensitive stomach like I do with certain things, the irritable bowel, all that, and don't want to go running to the magic room, you just hold the butter because they broil the steaks in butter. And this one didn't need the butter. It was so juicy and so tasty and so tender. Oh, man. That piece of meat was so unbelievable. Ad boycott doesn't deter Texas editor who endorsed Kerry. The editor of the Crawford, Texas Weekly that bills itself as President Bush's hometown newspaper says he has no regrets about endorsing Bush's Democratic opponent, John Kerry, even after a dozen businesses pulled their ads from the publication. See, that's the way they do it.
Right.
They use their advertising money to, like, you know, pressure people politically, which is a pile of crap.
No,
I do it again. I do it again. Leon Smith, publisher of the Lone Star Iconoclast, told the Waco Tribune Herald in yesterday's editions, the Iconoclast, which endorsed Bush in 2000, said it now supports the Democrat because of disillusionment with the war and Bush's actions on Social Security, the economy, and other issues. An editorial dated September 29th accuses the president of having a smoke-screened agenda and leading the U.S. into a quagmire in Iraq on flimsy pretenses. Boy, that's pretty perspicacious on their part. He's got his thumb right on it. The newspaper, with a circulation of 425, has become scarce, and copies have shown up on the eBay online auction site. Business leaders in Bush's adopted hometown of 705 residents about 20 miles west of Waco say they support the president. They're critical of the upstart newspaper. I think what's-his-name, Leon Smith, is entitled to his own opinion, said Vicki Martin, an employee at the Coffee Station convenience store and cafe where Bush sometimes stops during stays at his ranch. Unfortunately, his opinion hurt a lot of feelings around here. Bush is our neighbor, y'all. And they're pissed off and fired up down there in Crawford. Hum and drear, that's what they're saying, like in Waco. Cuba policies have some rethinking their support for president, says today's Sun Sentinel. How do you like that?
Oh, my God.
Like many Cuban Americans, Alex Pezon, another Pezonavante, no doubt. Alex Pezon has been a staunch Republican most of his adult life. Pezon of Lake Worth has voted to put George Herbert Walker Bush, Bob Dole, and George W. Bush in the White House. This time, Pezon is committed to voting for Democratic nominee John Kerry because he blames Bush for keeping him separated from his wife, Maydell, who's in Cuba, waiting to come to the U.S. of A. Although President Bush is expected to win a majority of South Florida's Cuban-American vote, many Cuban-Americans have increasingly criticized his administration.
Incredible.
That could be a problem for Bush, who by some estimates won about 80% of the Cuban vote in 2000. Any erosion of that support could be significant since allegedly he won the Florida by 537 in 2000, once they re-jiggered it. The turning point for Pezon, who met his wife about 3 years ago in Cuba, married her last year, was the recent policy that restricts Cuban Americans to one family visit every 3 years. Before the change, Cubans could go once a year without a treasury license, and each year Pezon received permission for additional visits. Because he thinks the Bush administration's policy is too harsh, Pezon is pinning his hopes on Kerry's promises to allow principal travel to the island. If your mom is in Cuba, she's dying of some illness, you can't go, Pezon said. Suppose your wife is having a child, you can't go. Life isn't black and white, but the law now is like that. The Bush administration's unveiled a series of measures in May following months of pressure from some Cuban-American Republicans who decried what they perceived as a lack of action in Cuba policy by the Bush administration. The new policies designed to cut the flow of U.S. dollars to Cuba's government included the regulations cutting down on family visits. While many Cuban exiles praised the move, others in the community protested the action, saying they would divide families. Now, wait till you hear the quotes from the obnoxious Ileana Ross, Rosanna Dana-Layton. We've got to fire up the troops and get them out, said Cuban-American U.S. Republican Representative Ileana Ross, Rosanna Dana. She's got another quote in here, too. It goes on about this poll said that, and Sergio Bendixson said this, and where is it? Where's the thing? Here's what she says. Ross Layton said many Cuban Americans agree that the new Cuba measures are the right move. You see, she wouldn't disagree with Bush if he farted in her face. The challenges for Republicans on Election Day involving making sure Cuban Americans vote, she said, including logistics such as how to get elderly voters to the polls, she expects a positive turnout. Now, wait till you hear this paragraph. I think President Bush is going to be receiving a good, wonderful, hefty percentage of the Cuban exile vote. I think the president's done very well in fulfilling his promises to the exile community.
Huh? Which one?
Isn't that a bunch of crap? The exile community. People like her, bitches like Ileana Rosanna Dana, keep perpetuating that whole crap about, you know, oh, we're just here waiting like a hotel for a few years.
About 30, man.
Maybe go back. Well, you know what? Get on your banana boat and go back, this exile crap. Stuff it, baby. Stuff it where the moon don't shine.
Rectum.
That's right. And Ileana, you can stuff it, too.
Incredible.
Crazy, idiotic bitch. Dumber than a box of rocks. Not that I want to get worked up about it on a Monday. Don't forget, today's the last day to register to vote. I just mentioned that in passing.
The Howard Stern Show. Neil Rogers, mornings and midday. And sports around the clock. 560 QAM.
I am Frau Ileana Ross Leitman, and I like scrubbing my smelly gorilla ass with soap made from jewels and listening to the Neil Roque Comunista Hour. Hey, Brian!
Now, Inside Edition.
We've got candid videos of George Bush on front of the mirror preparing for the debate.
Dick Cheney can be president.
And a faithful Muslim.
and
the country has had no finer vice president than Saddam Hussein.
and they never stop thinking about new ways to harm our country and our people, and neither do we. Abu Ghraib. And
I admitted that Dick Cheney
was an Al-Qaeda associate.
Stay tuned. There's more Inside Edition to come.
And don't forget he left out
Abu Ghraib.
12 noon at 560 WQM. We got the Mad Dog, Jim Mandich, who's going to be, man, he's going to be scathing today, I'll bet. Can you even begin to imagine? After yesterday, after four, each week seems to be getting a little bit worse. Anyway, he'll be on it, too. We got the Humper at 4, Hank Goldberg. Geldy's making a little bit of appearance this week every now and then. Steve Goldstein at Smoky Bones at 7 o'clock tonight. Eddie K at 10. That's what Mo said about Geldy. He thought he had smoky bones. Charles Pete Conrad, astronaut. America didn't even blink, much less shed a tear, says some faxer. Where are these coming from?
The other room. It just took me the whole break to fax them.
Well, why are you doing that? Why can't you just, you could read these. Well, of course, you're hopped up from that damn coffee.
Yeah.
Ed in Fort Lauderdale says, oh, yes, this is a good one. Julia Child. She used to put about a quart of Jack Daniels and everything that she cooked. She was like petrified. I'm not talking about scared. I mean, like as in the petrified forest.
Pickled.
Pickled is the word. All of us watched Julia Child at one time or another. Not much fanfare when she passed. Please add her to the list. Although I think she was like 90-something.
Something like that. Somebody suggests Frank Zappa, and we concur.
Oh, Frank Zappa?
Right.
How come he wasn't on there already? That was my bad. Because we got...
Hey there, people, I'm Bobby Brown.
But that's enough of that. I don't want to get Joyce all upset on a Monday. Here's a fax from the Palm Beach Troublemaker, which says, I've listened to you forever. As a good loyal QM listener, I'm trying desperately to listen as a new listener to Stern. Can anyone explain to me what the quacking noise he keeps playing is? And why do they all think it's so funny? They'll never explain it. I don't know, because I don't listen. It says, got anything else, Neil? Anything else? See, you're knocking the Howard again. Don't be doing that.
Absolutely.
Right? Don't be knocking the Sternmeister and Robin and Baba Booey and Arnie and all of these people, okay? See, I'm thinking that maybe it's a cheap channel. I'm just thinking out loud. I have no evidence. I'm not accusing, although I'm thinking. That thing with the Spanish language stuff coming on in the background, not interfering with 560. They know that they're going to take it really deep into the colon. Now that we got this award-winning lineup, I'm talking about Stern and yours truly and the Mad Dog and the Humper. My God, that's just awesome is what that is. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
Yeah. And not only is that awesome, but, of course, what also helps is...
No more.
Yeah.
No
more. That can't hurt at this point.
No
more. No more.
That's what everybody's thinking but don't want to say because it's embarrassing. So they probably are like peeing in their pants, so it wouldn't surprise me if some shenanigans are going on there. Because Castro just got through cutting back on electricity last week. Maybe they had to cut back on electric to funnel all that juice to the 500,000-watt station he's cranked up there on 560.
They're having rolling brownouts we've been
hearing. You may think I'm exaggerating, but when I was on WS News in that episode I'm telling you years ago when he interfered with our signal, they cranked up a 500,000-watt station, because naturally they don't abide by international broadcast regulation, so there's no limit on 50,000 watts on AM. So they, you know, whenever they feel like it, they want to put some of their propaganda on, they crank up 500,000 watts. And you would think, if he had any brains, which he doesn't, but you'd think of all the stations to want to interfere with, this would be the last one. The anti-Bush voice, I mean, doesn't he hate Bush like poison?
Yeah, well, he just hates.
No, but I'm serious. He hates Bush, the Bushmeister, like poison. You think that one of the few, go ahead and do it on 940 for crying. No, that's the wrong one, too, although nobody's listening. Although I'll tell you, I'm really impressed by Al and that lovely, what's her name again?
Catherine Lambert.
Oh, are they going to make a big impact or what?
No.
Are they going to kick ass in this market?
No.
And the Randy tapes.
Well,
they're talking about stuff that happened the day before. What?
They want that speaker.
Question.
Offensive line, St. Clair.
No, we don't want that. What the hell do we want that for?
You tell us something important.
If they fire his ass or if something like that happens, we'll put it on immediately, if not sooner. That's the only kind of dolphin broadcast I'm putting on the air. I mean, what more needs to be said? It's a humiliating, degrading embarrassment. And the fact that he's actually out there bullcrapping, stonewalling. I mean, what can he say? We suck. We're pathetic. We're an embarrassment. We're the worst team in the league. We've taken the once mighty franchise and we've turned it just upside down. And of course, you know, that crap living in the past. How many years ago?
About 30, man.
You know, with a perfect season and the back-to-back Super Bowls, all of these things. And what do they got now? Now they got a perfect season that could be like
10-16,
which is not what the fans had in mind. Although I say fans very loosely because, like I said, I saw a lot of empty seats. I didn't see any rain yesterday. I didn't even see any pigeons in the sky. It looked to me like it was a beautiful day. I didn't see too many people there. I mean, you know, it was a sellout, but a lot of people just stayed home. Contemplated doing more interesting things, like maybe suicide, the Dolphin fans. 5670560, #560 on the AT&T and Verizon line. Who best fits this description? A celebrity whose death was least noted. Carol O'Connor, 100. And he's got it wrapped up, I think. We got 287 votes. From the bottom, Julia Child and Frank Zappa just went on, no votes. Chris Farley's got one. John Ritter's got two. Dave Thomas of Wendy's has got a pair. Love Dave Thomas. He was good. Desi Arnaz, 5. Easy E, 5. John Candy, 9. Ray Charles, 12. Alec Guinness, 17. Celia Cruz, 21. Jan Berry, 22. I'm surprised Jan Berry from Jan and Dean's doing real well. Aren't you surprised?
I'm surprised.
Phil Hartman, 26. Marlon Brando, 28. Yeah, he got hyped up pretty big, but not enough, though. Not enough clips from The Godfather. You know, that's what we needed. A lot
you
more.
You can act like a man!
Right.
What's the matter with you?
A lot more from that. Probably the Italian-American Foundation made him stop. Mo Howard, the real 137, as in Mo, Larry, Curly, and him. And like I said, Carol O'Connor's got 100. WQAM, hello.
Hey, Neil. How about yes? Bob Keeshan?
Bob Keeshan, Captain Kangaroo.
Absolutely. Everybody grew up with Captain Kangaroo.
Everybody grew up with Captain Kangaroo.
And also, that guy asked about the duck sound on Howard.
Yeah.
That's a porn star. That he lifted that from one of her movies. She's doing something to somebody.
I see.
And making that sound.
I see. She's ducking.
Something like that. I can't really say because Joyce may be listening.
Right, she's ducking or something that sounds like
that. Use your imagination. Right.
Okay. Now, are you having any signal issues on QAM?
No, I'm out in Cooper City, and I can barely hear something in the background, but it doesn't interfere with this show. So
oh, thank God.
Fine.
We're going to be giant in Cooper City. Thanks, sweetheart.
Okay, sure.
Have a great day. Bob Keeshan, Captain Kangaroo. Do we want to put that in parentheses? I don't know. Do whatever you want, Josh. You know, it's one of those deals.
Okay.
I mean, they should know who the hell Bob Keeshan is, shouldn't they?
They should.
But they might not. So just to be on the safe side, put Captain Kangaroo on there.
Well, I already just put his name.
Like I said, just put Bob Keeshan on would be good. WQAM, hello.
Yeah, hi, Neil, please.
Yes, sir, speaking.
Oh, hey, Neil. Fred Rogers.
You don't think they made a big Timothy? Yeah, you're right. You're right. It was about on a par with Bob Keeshan. I would say about the same.
Yeah, I mean, he raised, you know, half of our listeners, you know, that, I mean, I certainly remember, you know, growing up watching him more so than Sesame Street.
Okay, Pally, thanks.
Thank you.
On tonight's Action News, it's the reason Mr. Rogers had to retire. It's Mr. Rogers, the lost episodes.
Let's have some make-believe. I want to show you this toy that I brought. Yeah, it's just a toy, you know? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Put it back in, right in there. And out it comes. And what a good feeling. That was fun, wasn't it? Isn't it fun to pretend things like that? You can use your fingers.
On tonight's Action News.
But I guess you can see it's no secret what a good feeling they gave me. Oh, you're coming, and Mr. McFeely's coming.
Yeah, I bet you he was an old pervert, you know? I mean, we'll never know, but...
No, we never will.
Any guy that dresses up with sneakers and a sweater like that, I'm just worried about
him. Cardigan, man.
Right.
Slippers.
1208 at 560 WQM. Things are going to look up, folks. Forget about the Dolphins, okay? We got the bigger fish to fry. The Panthers will not lose a game this season. That's my prediction. WQAM, not that anybody would care anyway. QAM, hello.
I care. Hi, Neil. I'm going to make your day.
Okay.
Okay. There's a TV show on, I don't know if it's CBS, ABC, or NBC, and the lovely and delicious Miguel from Passions is on it. I don't know if anybody did tell you.
No.
No. It's called Desperate Housewives.
Yeah. In other words, it's a new show that he's got a recurring part in, is what you're saying?
Well, it's a new show. It's an hour-long show on Sunday nights at 9 o'clock.
Yeah.
I don't remember. While I was flipping it and the TV, too, I happened to see him, like, having a little fun with some woman bare-chested.
I'll be damned.
So I figured that maybe that
might be... He's probably bailed on the show because he hasn't been on there in a long time. Passions is losing all of the regular characters. We got all these phony baloney people in there. And
right.
He probably is off of that show.
Well, he went to go chase charity to New York.
There you go.
And then what's his name? Alistair is not the same Alistair. It's a different voice.
Right. Not just a different voice. Haven't you seen him? It's a different actor. We got... which he got shot by... what's her name? Mrs. Walker. Or Mrs. Whatever the hell her name was.
It's great. It is like so, you know, you can, you know, they can't find each other in a thimble. You know, Louise dies and Sheridan dies and they
right.
all come back to life.
That's right. Nobody ever dies in there except poor Timmy. Okay, thanks for the good news, Pally. We'll set our sights on Miguel. And the lovely Miguel. 5670560. Yeah, the show is really sucking big time. And nobody has faxed me or called. I've been asking for days if this guy that played Alistair now, Alistair Crane on Passions, it was the original one before, which is why we didn't see the face or the any of that for like 3 years since I've been watching it. That's the only thing that I can think of, why they're showing the face now again. Maybe this was the original one. But who the hell knows, okay? They got bigger fish to fry, like the fish, the dolphins. WQAM, hello.
Neil, I have somebody for the poll. Barry White.
Barry White. Nobody even farted when he died, you know?
No, sorry.
Okay, thanks.
All right.
Was Barry White?
No.
I wasn't a big Barry White fan. But then again, all the people out there, all the who were into slush, people that used to listen to The Coast, rest in peace. Is The Coast still on? What is The Coast now? Or is The Coast Party? What station?
The Coast is still on.
Well, The Coast is still coasting along.
Right.
How's Johnny Dark doing? Anybody heard from Johnny Dark?
Not lately.
I'll be damned. That's probably good news. Maybe Johnny Van Moosten went off to Europe. He was so impressed with it.
We used to have
You're
a jingle we
Johnny.
Could play about it.
Huh? No, we better not.
We used to have one.
Oh. Yeah, now that you mention it, there's another one that we can't play anymore, and that really breaks my heart. Can I play just a tiny bit?
Johnny Dark!
Oh, well, yeah. Not that one. We can play that, but...
Johnny Dark said
no, see, that was... What? That was okay.
Nice team effort there, too.
Now, wait a minute. Just a minute.
Okay.
Johnny Dark
said, "Oh, that was great." See, I can do these live. I got so much practice now. Although there was a little bit of the S of the S.
Yeah.
Sorry, Joyce. Okay, we'll try to do it a little bit cleaner next time, so to speak.
Rectum.
Nothing like a clean S. 5670560 #560 on the Verizon and Singular wireless lines. WQAM. Hello.
Yeah, I want to speak to Neil. I got someone for the list.
Speaking.
Al.
I beg your pardon? Alf?
Yeah. This Neil?
Yeah.
Neil, how are you?
Okay. Is
I
this Alf?
Yeah.
Go ahead, Alf.
I'm sorry. I want you to put Raul Julia.
Who is it?
Raul Julia.
Who's that?
Who's that? He's a good actor.
What was he in? What did he do?
He was in, give me one second here. He was in,
yeah, he must have been big.
Come on.
Was he the guy that invented, I think he was the guy that invented Orange Julius. No, I forget about that. That guy. Raul Julius. Get out of here. Speaking of Orange Julius, I haven't had that in a long time. And they still, now, do they still have Orange Julius around in the malls? Because they got it here.
Yeah.
Do they? You ever had it?
Of course.
I like the strawberry Orange Julius is my favorite.
I agree.
Just like, it's like taking a needle and injecting just a pure sugar into your veins, sugar water.
That's
fantastic. 1213 at 560 WQM. Guaranteed mortgage bankers are prepared to help you meet all your financing needs. If you're a first-time home buyer or if you're refinancing and taking cash out, they are your best choice. Guaranteed mortgage bankers are committed to excellent customer service. It's not only their promise to you, it's their guarantee. So call them today, 1-800-734-6616. At Guaranteed Mortgage Bankers, their goal is to build a lifelong relationship with their customers, which is precisely what they did with a couple who moved down to Florida from New Jersey. They hadn't started their new jobs yet, but they did find a house that they fell in love with. Couple haven't lived in town for more than a week. They had very little money to put down. They wanted to close desperately in 10 days. And the good news is that Guaranteed Mortgage Brokers was able to secure the buyer's needs in order to close on time. And they were able to give them 95% financing at the unbelievable rate.
Unbelievable.
Of just 5.95%. And listen to this, Guaranteed Mortgage Brokers sends all of its clients on a fabulous seven-night cruise. It's their way of saying thank you for choosing them and giving them your business. Guaranteed Mortgage Bankers, no loans are too big or too small, and no credit is too bad. And, of course, if you have good credit, that helps. They'll work with you to get you the loan you need. Guaranteed Mortgage Bankers, call them today, toll-free, 1-800-734-6616. That's 1-800-734-6616.
You're listening to Neil Rogers exclusively on 560 QAM.
God. Goodbye, Tom Coleon. My fat baboon. Not so much to Hagen to tell Sammy that he's got bad news. The first time. You're not still alive. That's your commas, no surprise.
I'm going to make him an offer he can't refuse.
Yeah, too late. 1218 at 560. You know who else is Canadian? Jim Carrey.
Yeah.
And William Shatner.
Yes, indeed.
I'm compiling the list for tomorrow. That's going to be a good poll. 5670560, pound 560 on the Verizon and Singular Wireless lines on a mediocre Monday. It's okay. A lot of depression. Haven't had too many calls. I mean, really, you know, when Clarence says, well, why don't you just do a dolphin show just for us, just for once? You know, like, thank God he ain't programming this show or have anything to do with this show. He is such a knucklehead. That's all he knows. And, you know, some days he pretends to be like a program director, you know, program director junior, but then he reverts to that
sports
crap. And that's it. That's his the sum of his entire existence is strictly
sports.
Man, the sports nerd fraternity, we can't stand it. We can't handle it. Go away, Clarence, and get my check on time next time or else. WQAM, hello. Nice talking to you. WQAM, hello. QAM.
Hey, I got somebody for your poll.
Okay.
Gregory Hines.
Gregory Hines. I love this ketchup, though. Thanks a lot. See ya. H-I-N-E-S. I guess you know that already.
We do.
Don't you?
From the facts
we have. Well, I know you do. Huh?
Yes.
Are we ahead of facts on it?
No. Facts on some other people.
Like?
Jack Lemmon.
Jack Lemmon!
And Rick James.
Jack Lemmon was great, especially when he said...
Push the button, Max!
That was my favorite.
Yes, that was Jack Lemmon, by the way.
I heard it was Jack Lemmon, is what I heard. You know my favorite Jack Lemmon movie?
I give up.
And that's because of my anti-religious fanaticism, but my favorite was Mass Appeal.
Very good.
Yeah. I hated Yugoslavia. And Charles Durning was great in there, too. You know, Charles Durning, us fat people, we got to like the fat actors, you know, like William Conrad, Charles Durning. He's great. When a Stranger Calls, a very underrated movie. You know, in that genre, it wasn't a great movie, but of the horror, scary, thriller kind of movies, it was damn good.
Have you checked the children?
What?
And the other one was Rick James.
Rick James. Oh, yeah, well, he just died.
Right.
And then we found out about how many drugs in his blood?
About 30, man.
Okay, Rick James. Well, He's a little on the freaky side.
Not anymore.
I'm dying over here. I'm with Dave, bitch.
WQAM, hello.
Neil.
Yes, sir.
What's up, Neil, buddy? Listen,
yeah,
I got one for your poll.
All right.
And I've got a request.
Yes.
Hank the Angry Dwarf. And can I call myself a douchebag?
That was really perfect. Running all the way around. Yeah, at least, at least you're consistent. Maybe not good, man, but at least consistent. Jimmy Carter says, still seeking a fair vote in Florida. This is an article he wrote yesterday, as a matter of fact. He says, after the debacle in Florida 4 years ago, former President Gerald Ford and I were asked to lead a Blue Ribbon Commission to recommend changes in the American electoral process. After months of concerted effort by a dedicated bipartisan group of experts, we presented unanimous recommendations to the President and Congress. The government responded with the Help America Vote Act of October 2002. Unfortunately, many of the Act's key provisions have not been implemented because of inadequate funding or political disputes. The disturbing fact, Jimmy writes, is that a repetition of the problems of 2000 now seems likely, even as many other nations are conducting elections that are internationally certified to be transparent, honest, and fair. The Carter Center has monitored more than 30 elections, all of them held under contentious, troubled, or dangerous conditions. When I describe these activities, either in the U.S. or in foreign forums, the almost inevitable questions are, why don't you observe the election in Florida, and how do you explain the serious problems with elections there? The answer to the first question is that we can monitor only about 5 elections each year, and meeting crucial needs in other nations is our top priority. Our most recent ones were in Venezuela and Indonesia, and the next one will be in Mozambique. A partial answer to the other question is that some basic international requirements for a fair election are missing in Florida. Can I read that sentence again?
Could you please?
A partial answer to the other question is that some basic international requirements for a fair election are missing in Florida. The most significant of these requirements are a nonpartisan electoral commission or a trusted and nonpartisan official who will be responsible for organizing and conducting the electoral process before, during, and after the actual voting takes place. Although rarely perfect in their objectivity, such top administrators are at least subject to public scrutiny and responsible for the integrity of their decisions. Florida voting officials have proven to be highly partisan, brazenly violating a basic need for an unbiased and universally trusted authority to manage all elements of the electoral process. He couldn't be thinking of Catherine Harris and Donna in the Hood and fat-ass Governor Jeb Bush, could he, huh?
Absolutely.
Uniformity in voting procedures is essential, Jimmy says, so that all citizens, regardless of their social or financial status, have equal assurance that their votes are cast in the same way and will be tabulated with equal accuracy. Modern technology is already in use that makes electronic voting possible with accurate, almost immediate tabulation and with paper ballot printouts so that all voters can have confidence in the integrity of the process. There is no reason these proven techniques used overseas and in some U.S. states could not be used in Florida. It was obvious that in 2000 these basic standards were not met in Florida, and there are disturbing signs that once again, as we prepare for a presidential election, some of the state's leading officials hold strong political biases that prevent necessary reforms. 4 years ago, top election official, Florida Secretary of State Catherine Harris, was also the co-chair of the Bush-Cheney State Campaign Committee. The same strong bias has become evident in her successor, Glenda Hood. I keep calling her what I call her, Donna. Glenda Hood, who was a highly partisan elector for George W. Bush in 2000. Several thousand ballots of African Americans were thrown out in technicalities in 2000, and a fumbling attempt has been made recently to disqualify 22,000 African Americans, likely Democrats, but only 61 Hispanics, likely Republicans, as alleged felons. The top election officials also played a leading role in qualifying Ralph Nader as a candidate, knowing that two-thirds of his votes in the previous election came at the expense of Al Gore. She's ordered Nader's name be included on absentee ballots even before the state Supreme Court had ruled on the controversial issue. Florida Governor Fat-Ass Jeb Bush, normally a strong supporter of his brother, has taken no steps to correct these departures from principles of fair and equal treatment or to prevent them in the future. It is unconscionable. Let me say it again. It is unconscionable to perpetuate fraudulent or biased electoral practices in any nation. It is especially objectionable among us Americans who prided ourselves on setting a global example for pure democracy. With reforms unlikely at this late stage of the election, perhaps the only recourse will be to focus maximum public scrutiny on the suspicious process in Florida, writes Jimmy Carter. The suspicious process in Florida. You know what he is? He is
absolutely correct.
Got his thumb right on it. The old peanut farmer.
Where the hell was he, you know?
When it counted?
Back when, yeah, exactly.
Well, he's, you know, he's learning from his mistakes.
I guess so, I reckon.
In fact, we got more, another story. Thousands in Florida may be rejected the polls, which we'll get to. All kinds of stuff. Last night on 60 Minutes, they had one of the most insipid, idiotic stories. I got some crap on it later about the echo boomers. Those of you people out there, especially young people, don't let them label you. Run around with screaming, "Don't label me! Don't label me!" You know,
were there any
like
good stories on 60 Minutes last night? It seems like they were just doing a bunch of puff crap.
Yeah. Well, they're a little scared now.
Oh,
you know?
Yeah.
They're a little bit. They're running a scared.
That's tragic.
So we saw I had an interview with Bill Parcells, which is about a much business on 60 Minutes is, you know, a farting contest on the Today Show. Although that might be more entertaining than what's-his-name with his chemo haircut. 26 past noon at 560 WQM. I've been telling you for a very long time why if you want to get you a new mattress and a great night's sleep for a long time, shop at 1-800-MATTRESS like I do. Well, now I want to tell you even more. Dollar Mattress is proud to carry Sealy Posturepedic, the number one brand in mattresses. Call 1-800-MATTRESS today, and you'll get factory direct prices on all Sealy Posturepedics. When you call 1-800-MATTRESS, you'll get same-day delivery all across South Florida. And by calling that number, you'll choose from the deepest and widest selection of Sealy bedding, all available for same-day delivery. And as always, you pick the date and time for delivery, that two-hour window when it's convenient for you and your schedule, and Dollar Mattress shows up on time 99.7% of the time. Dollar Mattress is ranked number one in customer satisfaction. They were winners of the 2004 Better Business Bureau Local Torts of Excellence Award. Everybody with a brain, even a half of one, is called 1-800-MATTRESS for their bedding. You ought to be doing the same. Don't put a new bed today. Just pick up that phone, make the one easy call. If you want to check them on the web, you can do that too, mattress.com. But if you call right now, you can be sleeping like a baby as soon as tonight. 1-800-MATTRESS, 1-800-MATTRES.
You're listening to Neil Rogers exclusively on 560.
Hey, stench of cow manure hovers over this performance by the Dolphins.
Mother, mother, who can you turn to? To make a weapon from an old teaspoon. I know you're not a dyke, but your roommate will be. You have to use an open toilet to pee. Mother, you got your number. They're gonna slam the door. Mother, just wear your number. 5-5-1-7-4-4-5-4. Mother, mother, your career is screwed.
Yes.
You don't know if you're gonna get traded. For a carton of smokes and a gang tattoo. You tried your litigation, but the judge said you lose. Mother, you got your number. They're gonna settle the score. Mother, just wear your number.
1233, 2701 at 560. G in Coral Springs faction says the quacking sound on Howard Stern's radio show is supposed to be a parody of the time duck quack on Don Imus' radio show, as well as an inside porno star radio joke. If you're a Sternophile, this is supposed to be hilarious, as it is a dirty joke, and at the same time, a slam at Imus, who Stern hates with a passion. Great radio, huh? Writes G in Coral Springs. Well, can I say, you know? We just don't get it. We're not sophisticated enough to get it. Maybe we're just not echophiles, you know?
No.
I mean, echo boomers or whatever the hell that thing is. And maybe we don't have our iPods yet.
Speak for yourself.
You got your iPod?
Yes, I do.
I bet you Josh has got his iPod.
I do not.
You know?
He has a similar product, though.
I bet you he's more like of a Paul boomer than a echo boomer. Jerry and Bonita Springs says, what? Well, we can't make the sound.
Inside joke there, yeah.
We can't make the sound. From the crepitation contest. We can't make those farting sounds, can we?
No.
Oh, sorry, just checking. Stop. In the name of love.
That coffee.
Jerry in Bonita Springs says, I'd like to suggest Roy Orbison for today's poll. That's a very good one. Roy the Boy. Roy the Boy, and of course only fags would refer to him as Roy the Boy. Since you're having fags problems, I would also like to submit a name for tomorrow's Canadian Entertainer Pool. Please consider Neil Young. Is Neil Young?
No.
No, he's old like me. All Neils are. That's a good one. I'm going to have to, like, work on that. Who's that little twerpy comedian guy?
Which one can you know?
Yeah, I know, that's what I meant. Oh, there's so many of them. Well, they have these spots. When they carry American shows, like the soap operas, they don't have, like, real spots to fill, because they get to, it's a real scam. They get to put their own Canadian spots in there on those shows from the American networks that they carry. Like Passions, for example. So they have these Canadian, you know, to solve the Canadian ego problem, which is very serious. Oh, we're not just good hockey players. We've got all these great, look how great we are. You know, we got Mike Myers and Jim Carrey and
right.
All these people. What about Steve Martin? Isn't he Canadian?
I don't know.
I'm not sure of that. Look it up. Look it up, please, in the thing there. Josh, Steve Martin. I kind of think so. A lot of great Canadian comedians.
Yes, there are.
And then, of course, there was always Wayne and Schuster. Don't
Gene
put Levy, them on.
Martin Short, was that the twerpy comedian you
That's what
about?
I was thinking of, Martin Short. Very good. How did you get that?
I was just going through the list of twerpy comedians in my head.
Now, can I ask you a question?
All right.
Is Martin Short?
Yes, as a matter of fact.
Okay, he's no Randy Newman. And don't be putting Randy Newman on there tomorrow. He ain't Canadian. I hope not.
He might
be. Got enough problems with Celine Dion. Oh, anyway, a follow-up on that story by Jimmy Carter. Thousands in Florida may be rejected at polls. Thousands of Floridians who think they're registered to vote could be turned away at the polls November 2nd.
Oh, my God.
Because their voter registration forms were not completely filled out, officials said Friday. And especially if they intend on voting for Kerry, there's a real good chance that when in doubt, they'll throw him out. Secretary of State Glenda in the Hood said some groups registering voters are turning in application forms with information missing, such as unchecked boxes asking whether the applicants are citizens, mentally incompetent, or felons. Glenda in the Hood, speaking of mentally incompetent or felons. A group that's been seeking copies of the incomplete applications in an effort to help people complete them said Hood's office, citing state law, has begun blocking them. Oh, here we go again. Clearly, way over the number that could determine the election won't be able to vote, said Judith Brown, an attorney with the Washington-based Advancement Project, which promotes multiracial participation in voting. She was referring to President Bush's disputed 537-vote victory in Florida that gave him the presidency in 2000. During that election, state and local election officials were criticized on a host of issues, from people mistakenly removed from voter rolls to the infamous butterfly ballot in Palm Beach County that was put on there by that obnoxious departed bitch Teresa Lepore that may have led Al Gore supporters to vote for third-party candidate Pat Buchanan instead. While the Advancement Project is not registering voters itself, it assists groups that are, including American Families United, which tries to register voters in poor and minority communities. And you know who voters in poor minority communities generally vote for, don't you? Democrats.
No, I was going to say Nader.
We can't have that happening. I just saw Go Cardinals on here, so I know this fax you sent me is from Dave the Cop. Boy, he just, get a life, would you please?
I have no
God
life.
Almighty. What?
I tested this machine with that fax.
And it worked?
And apparently. If you see
how did it do that? It must have been a phone line thing in the back. Probably fixed it in the back. You know what I mean?
Rectum.
Anyway, American Families United is suing the Duval County election supervisor to get copies of 1,441 rejected applications there. Brown said a judge ruled against it Friday. Previously, the Advancement Project received copies of forms from Dade, Orange, Hillsborough, and other counties. In Dade and Broward alone, Brown said 12,000 incomplete ballots were turned in. Acting Duval election supervisor Richard Carlberg said his office is trying to call the 1,441 applicants to let them know they won't be able to vote unless the forms are completed, but said many of the phone numbers on the forms aren't working numbers. Probably like, you know, phones at gas stations, convenience stores, pay phones. Hood said her office is only trying to help election supervisors follow the law that incomplete forms must be rejected. Hood recommended that people who were registered by a group instead of at their county elections office should make sure they are really registered to vote. And if they're a little bit like that, they're like more than two shades darker than white, forget about it. Just stay home. She also said anyone registering to vote outside a county office should also double check to make sure that all information is accurate, forms are completely filled out, and that the group plans to turn the applications in before midnight tonight. Of course, that's the end of that's the deadline. It's the deadline, which means if you don't register and if you don't go ahead and vote for Kerry, we're all going to be dead, is what...
I'm dying out of
That's
here.
Why they call it the deadline. You got it? You idiots. Dave the Cop, who's chronic and has no life...
I have no life.
I recall one person who should have gotten some notoriety when she did. Oh, get out of here. You're crazy. Get out of here with Mother Teresa, who died when Princess Diana. Mother Teresa, who was going around the world peddling all of that archaic bullcrap like her partner in crime there with his schmata on his head. Who the hell is he kidding, Dave the cop? Nut job.
By the way, Steve Martin is from Texas.
What'd I tell you? Also, he says, on another note, if Bush was really 11 points ahead in the polls, you think there's no... Yeah, well, the L.A. Times poll, I was just reading about it. Before the debate, Kerry, they had nationwide poll. He was 1 point ahead. Now he's 2 points ahead after the debate. So something's really rotten in Denmark, you know, besides the fish. Something is really rotten in Copenhagen. Ever been to Tivoli Gardens?
No.
Forget about it. It says, I think there were a lot of people just waiting for Kerry to do something that would make him just look presidential. And yada, yada. Oh, go Cardinals, he puts her on the bottom. Dave the cop, you are so, when they take that Mother Teresa man, that wrinkled up old bitch, that prune face, and I hope you have a great life together, okay? In the afterlife. In the Netherland, in the whatever the hell they call it. Neverland? Never, nether, the ether? God, I'm starting to get the same thing you got from the coffee, only I didn't have it.
What, a buzz, a rush?
Oh, if I drink coffee, boy, I'm going to tell you, I have to make a run like
yeah,
you wouldn't
well.
Believe. Oh, man. You think that butter on a steak, that's small potatoes compared to coffee.
Right.
At any rate, let's move along because that'll lead us into uncharted territory.
Rectum.
And Joyce will start rattling her spear again over there.
Did move along anyway, so yeah.
Right. 20 before 1, well, that's always a good sign. Hey, we've talked about dry concepts on this show for over 20 years. I've used them in my homes for over 20 years. Nothing has changed. When it comes to having your carpet, your furniture, drapery clean, the only name you ought to be thinking about is Dry Concepts. And let's face it, your carpeting is as bad as your sink when it comes to a collector of germs. All that schmutz and crap and garbage gets down there deep into your carpet. So call Dry Concepts today and sanitize your home. They've got certified technicians who you can trust in your home. They'll dry clean your carpet the same way that the dry cleaners dry clean your clothing. The stains go away and they don't come back. Beware of those $5.95 per room scams. You'll never get that with Dry Concepts because they give you a guaranteed written price before they start the job. And Dry Concepts uses a rapid drying technique, so your carpets are dry in just an hour and a half. You're ready to rock and roll again. You really can clean today and entertain tonight. If they're good enough for me and for everybody I know, they ought to be good enough for you. You'd never use anybody else after you use them the first time. In Dade, Broward, and the Palm Beaches, call them toll-free, 1-800-248-55 since 1979.
You're listening to Neil Rogers, exclusively QAM.
Howard David's a bitch.
Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. And again, welcome on board United Airlines Flight 919, bound for Dulles International Airport. The movie on today's flight will be 13 going on 30, a delightful comedy starring Jennifer Garner from Alias.
What a crappy movie this is.
Johnny, thanks a lot.
What's up?
Speaking.
Actually, it's a wonderful movie that I think you really enjoy. Jennifer Garner is just a delightful young actress. You know, she didn't show anything in this movie.
Still on. Why did you tell me? You gotta push the button again.
Our flying time today.
Johnny.
What?
Got a problem. Big problem.
Wait a minute, the button's still on.
How many times do I have to tell you, don't say problem when I'm on the PA system?
How hard is it for you to hit that button?
I'm the captain. Don't talk back. Don't say problem when I'm on the PA.
We got a big problem with one of the passengers.
What's the matter with the passenger?
Apparently, he's not supposed to fly anywhere in the world.
What?
Remember that song, Peace Train?
No, I don't remember.
The Peace Train.
No, I don't remember.
Cat Stevens. Yeah, although he's not Cat Stevens anymore. He's something like Yusuf Muhammad or something.
Ladies
and
gentlemen, from the cockpit, this is your captain. Can I ask you just to stand by for 1 second? But there is no problem. Okay, thank you.
So what's the problem? He's not supposed to fly anywhere. He's on the list where you're not
the
supposed to.
The button is still on! So you know what? It's not my fault! But the button sticks!
All you have to do is...
It sticks! All right, now what did you do with Cat Stevens? He's not supposed to fly. How did he get on board? Never mind, don't tell me how he got on board. I don't want to know. What'd you do with him?
The only thing we could do, we locked him in the bathroom.
You what?
We locked Cat Stevens in the bathroom, the guy who sang Peace Train.
Ladies and gentlemen, from the cockpit, this is your captain. You may hear some banging on the aircraft during today's flight. I just wanted to let you know that that is nothing to be worried about. It's Cat Stevens who we had to lock in the bathroom. Apparently, he's not allowed to fly anywhere in the United States. I'll be right back with an update for you.
So what the hell is going on? What are you going to do with him? I don't know, but did you see Sally back there today?
Ooh. Oh, my God, she looks amazing.
Awesome. I cannot wait till we land in Dulles because I'm going to take
the back. The button is still on! Get the button fixed! I'm the captain. I don't fix buttons. Will you put it on the list to get it fixed?
Ladies and gentlemen, from the cockpit, this is your captain. We're going to have to land in Maine and dump off Cat Stevens, who apparently is not allowed to fly anywhere in the United States. So we appreciate your patience.
This might be the most screwed up, ridiculous flight I've ever been on. You got me.
Good God, the button is on!
Hello, this is Albert Kaida from Taliban Records inviting you American infidel to buy latest Cat Stevens collection.
You know Muhammad is right. Take your head off your body. Got a machete with a real sharp blade. How I wish I had an American hostage. Make those infidels pay.
Also including this classic.
I was on an airplane and suddenly was detained. Their matches I converted. And wear a towel on my head. I'm being followed by an F-16. What do they want with me?
The money from your purchase does not go to fund terrorism, really.
It's not time to get off the plane. Just relax and take it easy. You're just dumb, that's your fault. It wouldn't happen if I were a Jew. Fine dark skin and a rag, if you want a detainee.
Another variation on a classic.
I ask myself every day, which American should pay? Tell me, who would Muhammad slay?
Don't understand, you're everyone.
I'm cutting through the neck of a woman. She lifted her veil and exposed herself.
So buy new Cat Stevens collection today for $19.95. Or you can pay with Visa, MasterCard, or weapons of mass destruction.
12:49. We don't have Osama yet, or Al Zawahiri, or Mullah Omar, or all these going, but we got Cat Stevens.
Oh.
All right, we're making some progress, baby. 427 votes on the poll. Who best fits this description? Celebrity whose death was least noted. The least song and a dance, the least bit of gnashing of teeth, the least bit of respect. Isn't that what we all that they should get? A little bit of respect and thanks.
The
thanks for the memories. Carol O'Connor, 109. Moe Howard, the real one, not the fake one.
Absolutely.
The real one, 54. Phil Hartman, 37. Marlon Brando, 34. Jan Berry of Jan and Dean fame, 28. Why is that? Why is he doing so good?
Got me.
Probably they didn't even know he was dead. Celia Cruz, 27. Frank Zappa, 25. Let's play Bobby Brown. Come on, you can do it. Put that license on the ground. Let's hear the whole thing, Bobby Brown. And that's exactly what we do.
Hey there, people. I'm Bobby Brown.
Well, good for you. Yeah, that was Joyce hitting the floor. Frank Zappa, 25. Alec Guinness, 21. Ray Charles, 19. John Candy, 12. Eazy-E, 11. Dave Thomas of Wendy's, 10. Come on, have one more burger, Dave, before it's too late. Desi Arnaz, 7. Lucy! Rick James, 6. Gregory Hines, 5. Bob Keeshan, Captain Kangaroo, 5. Jack Lemmon, 4. Julia Child, 4. Chris Farley, 3. John Ritter, 3. Barry White, 2. And Fred, no relation to...
Oh, God.
Mr. Rogers had only one? Only one? I guess they did a whole song and dance about him when he croaked, didn't they?
They did.
Day after day after day. Hi there, boys and girls with the green, with the sweaters, the multicolored sweaters, the sneakers, the whole bunch of crap. The mailman. What the hell was the mailman's name?
I didn't really watch that show. Sorry.
I didn't either, but, oh, come on.
I didn't like it.
Mr. And then.
Yeah.
Speaking of bits that we can't play. Please don't tell me you've forgotten already. I'll find it. One moment, please. There it is. No, that's not it. No, what I was thinking more like was...
Hi there, boys and girls. Today...
Yeah. Joyce would love that, playing bagpipes.
You kidding?
It's just a Scottish thing to do. That's all it is. Joyce, don't get all bent out of shape at us. It's just a Scottish thing.
Right. You can't say either one of those two words anymore.
Oh. Playing... pipes. Male hoax suspects theories revealed. I love this story. This is one of my all-time favorites. A Tennessee man accused of sending powder-laced envelopes to Broward County cities was convinced Fort Lauderdale police transplanted mind control devices in gays to help authorities find drug dealers, according to the man's weekly newsletter. Dane Swindell, 46, also claimed in his newsletter that Fort Lauderdale Police Chief Bruce Roberts illegally arrested gays to give Mayor Jim Noggle and Broward Sheriff Ken Jenny the impression that he was cracking down on crime. They descended on the gay community like flies on sugar, wrote Swindell in the September 9th edition of the Orwellian Chain Letter.
I bet you he didn't say that the first time, though.
FBI agents arrested Swindell at his Memphis, Tennessee home Friday and charged him with sending bomb threat letters to 8 Fort Lauderdale area elementary schools in August and in September if the schools opened election polling places. Jenny said Friday that Swindell admitted sending the letters and 25 envelopes containing white flour to Broward City halls. Swindell has not been charged with sending the envelopes. However, prosecutors said they were considering more charges against him because of the widespread mailings which arrived Thursday and Friday and prompted fears of another anthrax attack. Oh, it's been so long since I've had a chance to play, wait a minute, where the hell is it?
Anthrax.
Attack. Like the one in October 2001 that killed American Media Inc. photo editor Bob Stevens in beautiful Boca. The newsletters reviewed Saturday by the Sun Sentinel do not mention the 25 powder-laced envelopes or the bomb threat letters to the schools. It was unclear how long Swindell had published newsletters, which also listed the names and work phone numbers of other prominent state and Broward officials. In his newsletters, Swindell claimed he was the victim of an illegal conspiracy hatched by Jenny, Roberts, and Noggle. In the conspiracy, Fort Lauderdale police would plant brain transmitters through the ear canals and into the brains of gay jail inmates. I told you it was my favorite. The inmates, whom he called the Sting Team, were then sent to the streets, and someone inside Fort Lauderdale police headquarters would give them instructions through the transmitter. And if they don't do as they say, they make noise all night long until you go mad trying to get some rest, a September 12 edition of the newsletter said. The objective for them is very broad, but also specific. They want names of drug dealers. In the Orwellian, Swindell claimed he was outfitted with a transmitter around October 2002, and that police were trying to drive me crazy for the last 18 months. Well, looks like they did a good job. However, records show Swindell has never been arrested, nor has a criminal background. Swindell was also determined to find the device according to his newsletters. I've had, you're going to just love this. I've had 3 doctors, 1 CAT scan, 1 MRI, and yet no luck finding this little bug, Swindell wrote. Now it is time to go deeper and find exactly the people they're doing the talking and where they're permitting this activity to occur. During a news conference Friday, Jenny called Swindell an eccentric personality. That Ken Jenny, what a kidder, huh? The sheriff said Swindell has never undergone a psychiatric evaluation. Jenny also showed a copy of a letter Swindell sent him and other county officials in January. In the letter, Swindell claimed authorities were encouraging Broward jail inmates to harass and threaten him and that the malicious behavior caused him to have heart attacks and bicycle accidents. Swindell also said the actions prompted his former landlord in Fort Lauderdale, Greg Seidel, to cheat him out of his rental deposit. Seidel's wife, Mary Ann Seidel, declined comment Saturday. Tom Devine of Fort Lauderdale became acquainted with Swindell several years ago when Swindell, a self-employed architect, offered to design some furniture for him. He said Swindell never performed the work and sometimes mentioned his anger toward Broward County administrators. He was a drug addict and was frequently not normal, Devine said. J.M. Evans, a Hollywood private investigator who briefly ran for sheriff this year, said Swindell called him shortly after Evans announced his candidacy and that Swindell regularly sent him the newsletter. You really feel like you're talking to a straight-up and lucid guy, said Evans, referring to his conversations with Swindell. Then you listen to the content of what he's saying and just flat-out know that he's way out in left field. You know, there are mental issues when talking to him. Oh, I know some people like that who seem to be very lucid and very articulate, and then you find out when you listen to the essence of what they're saying and watch their behavior over a period of time, they're crazier than a bedbug. You know what I mean? You catch my drift?
No, who are you talking about?
Nobody in particular.
Oh.
5670560, #560 on the Verizon and Singular wireless lines. Doing pretty good on that poll. I thought this might go over like Halava in Siberia, but it's okay.
No, it's good.
It is good. WQAM, hello.
Hey, Neil.
Yes, sir.
You forgot one that's very near and dear to your heart for the poll.
Okay.
Don Cox.
Oh, yeah, right.
Yeah, well, you know, he's got a good fit. And that guy Swindell, the one that's going around.
Party. Yeah.
That's him. Go ahead.
Yeah, well, that guy has been posting stuff before he got busted. He was posting stuff in news groups, and he was sitting there, and his tagline on his emails was always that Bush had put this thing in his head in 2000, and death to the Judean Christian police state. The guy was a nut. You would find his stuff in the weirdest news groups.
Yeah.
And he would mention the Orwellian and all this stuff, and everything had all these little Orwellian quotes at the end, about 6 pages of this stuff from 1984 and the rest of the crap that Orwell wrote. And he's preaching it like a Bible. The stuff would just make you pee your pants in the
Well, I'm going to look it up. I could use a peeing in my pants. Oh, and speaking of that, there's steam rising above Mount St. Helens right now, and CNN's making a big go. Just in, there it is, steam rising about 10,000 feet above the crater's lip. How do you like that? Aren't you excited? They have made such a... Do you care about this?
No, well, I mean, we were there. I was pretty close to when it blew up the first time and dumped ash all over all of us.
Yeah.
And it doesn't seem like it's going to be doing anything
quite. It dumped on your ash?
Yeah, it did. So, yeah, it's just going to pish a little bit.
Yeah, it's pishing a little smoke above the lip.
I've got two sets of lips.
The Howard Stern Show. Neil Rogers, mornings and middays. And sports around the clock. 560 QAM.
It's not just the 1 to 2 hour. It's a phenomenon.
Celebrity fragrances have reached dazzling new heights. Elizabeth Taylor has white diamonds.
Ooh.
Jennifer Lopez has glow. And
now,
Courtney Love has chlamydia.
Chlamydia.
The enticing new aroma from Courtney Love's hole. Surprise the one you love by giving them chlamydia.
Chlamydia.
The contagious fragrance from Courtney Love. Look for the bottle shaped like a...
Uh-oh.
Well, just look for the bottle.
Chlamydia.
Available at Smears, Rite Aid, JCPU, and all gangrenes locations.
It's 101 at 560. I like that bottle. It's shaped like a... Uh-oh. Now, did you hear that right there at the ass end of that? Let me just,
Uh-oh.
Well, just look for the bottle.
Chlamydia.
Available at Smears, Rite Aid, JCPU, and all gangrenes locations.
It didn't do it that time either. It's a good thing you dropped that in there. Maybe it was just our imagination. Maybe we're just hallucinating.
Yeah, that's it.
Anyway, activist holds anti-Nader hunger strike. Don't forget Mad Dog at 2. He's going to be ripping the Dolphins in ass for 2 solid hours. And then when he gets done, the Humper's going to come in and clean up and just tear Dave Wanstead apart cheek by cheek.
Rectum.
Now, I'm curious. Are we still doing the coaches show?
You know, that is a very good question. I don't think so.
Whatever happened to that? Well, of course, that would be pretty embarrassing. Well, I guess that disappeared, just like kind of the Brian Murray coaches show. That kind of vanished, too. Probably for the same exact reason, the embarrassment factor. No, I'm just curious because I hope the Humper doesn't have to go interview Wanstead every week. That would be a fate worse than death. A fate worse than having to watch a Dolphin game in person. See, at least when you're watching it on TV, you can be very amused and you don't miss... Let me also just say this to you, and I know that this is going to sound... Because a lot of you people are easily manipulated by the media, and you love your football. Okay, well, I enjoy my NFL football, too, especially the Patriots.
Oh!
18 in a row, by the way. But I do have the package, so I can flip back and forth between one game and the other, get every game on there. But the problem is there are no games. In other words, the games start, and then they all go into commercial like a conspiracy. Now, how is it possible that that there are times when every game is in commercial at the same time?
Yeah, you have the ticket, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, because it's all the pregame is all the same also.
It drives you crazy. Well, that's because it's just the two networks, Fox and CBS. I understand that. But I'm talking about once the game starts... I mean, you know, there's injury timeouts, or there are different things that happen. Maybe there are a lot of passes in one game that makes the game faster than games when they're like all running plays. Or the other way around. A lot of passes, if they're incomplete, makes the game slower. But the point being that how is it possible that there's no play? And then, of course, if you take the commercials out, and then you take the time when you're turning on and they're watching some guy writhing around on the ground, another injury, and it goes on for 3 or 4 minutes. Oh, now we got to go to another commercial because we got to get that in there while we got the injury timeout. It's so damn frustrating. I'm screaming at the set. Where is a play? Where is there any game? Even freaking Washington Cleveland, which I could care less about, any game, where is there something where there's actually a play going on? And that's not an exaggeration. It's reached the point now where it's really, I bet you if you condensed, if somebody took the time to condense down, and I'm not talking about just taking the commercials out. I'm talking about just the actual amount of time that the plays go on. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
From the time the quarterback takes the snap until the time the whistle blows when the play is over. If you just took all of the plays in the game, I bet you could watch an entire game in 20 minutes or less.
Less.
Maybe 10 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what does that say, you know, about this marathon that goes on for like three and a half hours, some of these games? Give us some action, baby. Give us something to watch, something to sink our teeth into, Tom Brady. Activist holds anti-Nader hunger strike. Santa Monica, California. a peace activist who once fasted for 63 days to protest movie violence and war toys, is launching another hunger strike to persuade Ralph Nader to abandon his presidential bid. See, when you heard the first part, you're thinking, boy, this is some real wacko.
No.
But now you hear this part, and you're thinking, this is a great American. Oh, look who it is. Jerry Rubin. I didn't know that. I didn't even know he was still around. I thought maybe he was dead. Oh, I got another one for our poll, by the way. David Brinkley.
Okay.
Don't you think?
Absolutely.
I mean, just because his eyes were falling out of the sockets on that Sunday morning show doesn't mean that we shouldn't have disrespect. David Brinkley, he was out with Chet Huntley and Huntley Brinkley for how many years?
About 30, man.
And then on that Sunday morning abortion air with Sam Donaldson and that bad hairpiece and George Will, the Nazi in training in drag. Jerry Rubin, 60, said he plans to consume only liquids from Saturday until November the 2nd if Nader doesn't take a meeting with him. That was this past Saturday. I know Ralph Nader. I don't think he's doing the right thing, Rubin said. He said the Consumer Advocates campaign is dividing the progressive political movement. Many believe the votes Nader received in Florida in 2000 would have gone to Al Gore had Nader sat out the election. Gore lost the state supposedly by 537. And matter of fact, right there, forget about the butterfly ballot. Forget about Teresa Lepore. Forget about Catherine Harris. Forget about fat-ass Governor Jeb Bush. Forget about all these things. All you need to know is one person, Ralph Nader. I think they ought to stuff his ass in the 65 Corvair and put it in the ocean, okay, for a few months, then let him come back. What a piece of crap. Rubin is often... Oh, it's not the same guy. See, he is dead. I was right. Rubin is often confused with now-deceased Chicago 7 defendant Jerry Rubin. He legally changed his name to Jerry Peace Activist Rubin to avoid confusion with the 60s radical. Yeah. The peace activist is no stranger to hunger strikes. In 1988, he broke a two-month fast with a bite from a giant pizza topped with a pepperoni pizza on that he then left for Rambo star Sylvester Stallone. He again fasted in 1997 to persuade movie production company DreamWorks SKG to abandon plans to relocate its headquarters to Wetlands. He collapsed after 26 days, but DreamWorks abandoned the idea, saying it could not reach a satisfactory financial agreement. So let's hear it for Jerry Rubin, the one who's still alive. Jerry, what is it again? What's that name?
Rubin Sandwich.
No, seriously. Jerry Peace Activist Rubin. Jerry P.A. Rubin.
Whatever. It's like a Monty Python name.
Right.
Raymond Luxury Yacht.
5670560, pound 560 on the AT&T and Verizon wireless line. Haven't had too many people knocking the Dolphins here today. That's going to disappoint Clarence. He thought that's all people want to talk about. We got an election coming up 4 weeks from tomorrow, and our program director here at your sports nerd station, WQM, that's all he knows about is the Dolphin game yesterday, which most of you are probably trying to forget about, I would think. Wouldn't you think?
Absolutely.
You bet.
Already have.
I mean, what's there to rehash, huh? Crap. Garbage, pathetic, embarrassing. Even little school kids are humiliated. They're probably burning their Dolphin paraphernalia right now, wouldn't you think?
They're all
going to
laugh at you.
Exactly. WQAM, hello.
Yeah, Neil.
Yes, sir.
That Dolphin stuff's old news. No one wants to talk about it anymore anyway.
Exactly. Right? Tell Clarence to get a life. Get his own show.
Listen, I missed part of the show today, but what was the Canadian poll on?
And we're going to do a tomorrow, your favorite Canadian celebrity.
Oh, okay, but you're not taking calls on that now yet.
Well, I mean,
right?
If you want to give me one for the list, I can stick it on there.
You got Lauren Green yet?
Lauren Green, all right.
That's a good one, isn't it?
Took his shirt off? So you told me. Well, I don't know. Why did you see him with his shirt off?
I don't know how that happened. He's just a very hairy guy.
Oh, God. Had a pretty face, but from the neck down, toss it out. When in doubt, just toss it out. Anyway, I'm a Generation Xer, and he used to talk in those
labels.
Terms all the time. And I've never really encountered anybody before who seriously referred to themselves as a baby boomer, a Generation Xer, Y-er, any of those. Because this is the way they brainwash people into believing, because the government and the media being part of a pawn of that, they don't want you to be like individuals. They want you to be part of a group. They want to, like, lump you all in together so they can sell you crap, so they can tell you what you're supposed to be wearing and eating and driving, all of these things.
So they can goose-step in line.
Right, that's right.
And with your group.
Exactly. It says, according to CBS, if you've ever wondered why corporate America, Hollywood, Madison Avenue, and the media all seem obsessed with the youth culture, the answer is simple. The latest generation of young people since the 1960s is beginning to come of age. It's called echo boomers because they're the genetic offspring and demographic echo of their parents, the baby boomers, the echo boomers. You see, are you following this now? I want to make sure you follow the connected dots, follow the bouncing ball. Their parents were the baby boomers, and now they're like an echo image. They are. The Paul Boomers, which means they fart a lot. born between 82 and 95. There are nearly 80 million of them. They're already having a huge impact on the entire segment of the entire segments of the economy. And as the population ages, they'll become the next dominant generation of Americans. Who are they? Well, Steve Crawford had a report on 60 Minutes last night, which you obviously didn't see, and you ought to have kissed the ground you didn't.
I am.
And whether you call them echo boomers, Generation Y, or millennials, they already make up nearly a third of the U.S. population, already spend $170 billion of their own and their parents' money.
Why?
Their own and their parents' money. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
Like you said, Generation
Why?
Or echo boomers. I mean, that has got to be the most stupid-ass crap. Almost none of that money is spent on boring things like mortgages and medication. And the world is falling all over itself trying to sell them things. What brands do they love? Sony, Patagonia, Gap, Gillette, and Aveda. Well, what's the big deal with Gillette?
What's the big deal with Aveda?
Perone? No,
yeah.
No, seriously. I mean, why would they put... What, I mean, I've been shaving with Gillette with those those razors for a zillion years now. What's the big deal with it?
Mm-hmm.
Would you use, like, Gillette aftershave? What do they call that? The Gillette makes that crap. Oh, man, it'd be worse than using Old Spice.
Electric shave or whatever?
Oh, God.
They make more than one.
No, that's Menin. That's Menin.
Yeah, you're right. I don't know what it is.
Only a small percentage are eligible to vote, yet they're already... Now, how do you like that? Only a small percentage are eligible to vote, yet they're already one of the most studied generations in history by sociologists, demographers, marketing consultants like Jane Buckingham of the Intelligence Group. Remember the Buckinghams?
Yes.
Susan... Buckingham uses focus groups to gather information for clients such as NBC, Chanel, Nike, and Levi Strauss. Echo boomers are a reflection of the sweeping changes in American life over the past 20 years. They're the first to grow up with computers at home in a 500-channel TV universe. They are multitaskers with cell phones, music downloads, instant messaging on the Internet. They're totally plugged-in citizens of a worldwide community. I'm going to tell you something. Remember I had my two dogs?
Yes, I do.
Even the two of them on a day when they both had a bad bowl of grits and were in the backyard like really cutting loose, like you did this morning, even the two of them never unleashed such a crock of crap as this. No wonder CBS is going to be put off the air.
You're listening to Neil Rogers exclusively on 560 QAM.
I'm listening.
.17 at 560 WQM. That's another one for the poll tomorrow, Avril Lavigne.
Indeed.
Ain't nobody don't like Avril Lavigne, I hope.
So far.
Am I right?
I haven't found anybody yet.
5670560, #560 on the Verizon and Singular Wireless line. Who best fits this description? Celebrity whose death was least noted. And so far, my choice, Carol O'Connor, winning by a landslide. Carol O'Connor, 119. Mo Howard, the real one, although I don't think that's what they're voting for, 63. They hate you, Mo. Phil Hartman, 42. Marlon Brando, 36. Frank Zappa, 32. Jan Berry, 32. Celia Cruz, 27. Alec Guinness, 22. Ray Charles, 22. John and His Candy, 17. Dave Thomas and Wendy's, 15. And Eazy-E, 13. Bob Keesh and Desi Arnaz, 10. Everybody else, single digit. Small potatoes. WQAM, hello.
Hi. Wanted to talk to Neil.
Yes, ma'am. Speaking.
Hi, Neil. Forgot about that radio delay. Question for you. I moved here a year ago from Texas, where we had the same stupid Houston Oilers song as the Miami Dolphins song.
Right.
But here's a serious question, because I want my Chad to matter. What's better, absentee voting or early voting? I will not be here for the election.
What do you mean, what's better?
What has a better chance of really being counted?
Oh, early voting, I would think. Absentee ballots, they can just toss them out.
Okay. Well, I didn't know if I could trust early voting either, so I thought...
You can't trust any of it, but I think that would be better, and you might have a chance.
All right. Well, I figured you've been around a while. You could guide me.
We'll guide you right to the pool.
Thank you, sir.
Good luck. Thanks.
Bye.
Don't forget, today is the last day to register to vote, all you masses out there, all you people that are sick and tired of the lies, the deception, the BS, the born-again fundamentalist lunatics, the neocons, the tragic death, all the unwanted misery and suffering, tax cuts for the rich, rip-offs for Halliburton. I'm going to tell you, Dick Cheney, I hope he gets sliced by Edwards to a pulp tomorrow in that debate. Because he is one of the biggest crooks to ever come down the pike. He makes Nixon look like a Boy Scout. It's unbelievable. There isn't a week that goes by that there's not another story about how, in fact, we got one on the website either today or tomorrow, how he arranged all these backdoor deals, $123 million here and $17 billion over there, and Kellogg Brown and Root and Halliburton and this. Hey, it just never ends. That's why we don't see him. He doesn't have time to be seen because he's too busy making backdoor deals. Can I say backdoor? Sorry, Joyce. Not anymore. We can't. WQAM, hello.
Hello, Neil. How are we going to take it to the next level? The Dolphins just stink. I just can't believe it.
Oh, great. Are you sure?
Yeah.
How are we going to take it to the next level? Let me level with you, okay? Butt plug. WQAM, hello. WQM, hello.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi. I was calling to talk about the election.
Go right ahead.
Okay. Well, I just saw George Will in the airport, which is what reminded me guys brought him up. Yeah, I just saw him 30 minutes ago, and I wondered what he was doing here, if he was still left here from the debate or what. What I wanted to find out from you guys, actually, that's to do with the debates, the next debate, is where you think that's going to go and where the emphasis is going to go as far as the candidates, you know, preparations or whatever for the next debate.
The preparations? I think Bush is using a lot of preparation. H is the preparation he's using.
Yeah. Yeah.
The next debate is supposed to be on domestic issues, you know, like tax cuts for the rich.
Right. And the economy and all that.
Stem cell research and a woman's right to choose, things like that.
Okay.
Unemployment, all the 1.7 million jobs that Bush lost, things like that.
Yeah. Okay, I just wonder what you guys thought it was going to take for one of the candidates to really rise above the other.
I thought you saw that last Thursday, didn't you?
Well, yeah.
One of them to stand up and speak and the other one to show what a doofus he is and have a great day. Wow. Welcome to Lightbulb Radio, boys and girls. Now, what do you think? The right against the left and the... How about the death penalty? Should we talk about that?
No. Abortion. Coat hangers or poison drink?
Oh, boy. It's so hard to find, to ride that fine line, you know? You get chafed.
All around the rim.
Right. All around the rim. Room. Sorry, Joyce. It was just a slip of the tongue.
That's
WQAM, hello.
Not again.
WQAM, hello. WQAM, hello. Now, we've reached that point of the show where they've run dry out of material. I knew that was coming. QAM.
Neil, I saw a bumper sticker, an anti-Bush bumper sticker. It was rather funny. A girl had it on her car. It said, clean shaven, read my lips, no more.
Yeah, great. Okay, cute. Okay, so there's like, what, 75 in a row, something like that. But we'll press on. I'd like to get about 400 or 500 calls in between now and 2 o'clock, wouldn't you? Because once 2 o'clock comes, it's going to be that stuff that Clarence is waiting for, the gnashing of, oh, how do we get it to the next level? What are we going to do? Why is Wonstadt still in there? The Wonstadt era blows, you know. I still can't believe he's still there. WQAM, hello. I would have thought right after the game yesterday they put him on a bus. WQAM, hello.
Hello.
Yes, sir?
I would like to talk to Neil Rogers, please.
Speaking. Neil Rogers right here speaking.
Neil, I profusely apologize about not calling to send my condolences for your mom. I did not know that she passed. And second thing,
What does that mean? Did you know my mother?
No, I did not know, but I heard I'm an old-time listener. You know, every time I know Tuesday, you used to go and have lunch.
Yeah, well, that's ancient history, my friend. Plus, you're too old to talk to on this show. 5670 5. Oh God Almighty! What? Hey, all of a sudden we took a wrong turn in the road, man. First we got light bulb callers that want us to analyze the next debate next Friday, and then we got this guy who's older than Methuselah who's apologizing that he didn't call about my mother dying, which she's been dead for what, 80 months now, something like that. A long time. She's not even lukewarm anymore. God. WQAM, wow. Hello.
Hey Neil.
Yes sir.
He is good.
WQAM, hello.
Yeah, Neil.
Yes, sir.
Hey, I got through. Good. Did you see the 2020 piece on Neil Bush?
No.
Oh, my God.
Not about the Silverado banking and loan scandal, was
it? No. It's about screwing the whores in Hong Kong. That his wife found out about him screwing whores in Hong Kong free.
Right.
And they were taking the videotaped testimony for her divorce.
Mm-hmm.
And she told about how after 23 years of marriage, all she got was $30,000 a year for 4 years. And the
about 30, man.
Yes. Yeah. They cut her off. Now she's persona non grata.
Right. And then she went and gave all the info for the Kitty Kelly book.
Yeah. And he was on there, and he was saying, they said, how many whores came to the door? And he said, oh, I don't know. About 30, man. They said, did three come? He said, yeah, I think there was three. Did they have clothes on? He says, I don't know. They said, you mean to tell me you don't know if they were nude or they had clothes on? He said, yeah, they were naked.
And it's a classy family, man. Don't be knocking the bushes, okay? Don't be beating on the bush. Classy family. 567-0560, #560 on the Verizon and Singular wireless line. Not to mention, of course, that abortion in Texas that nobody wants to talk about. Go out and get the Kitty Kelly book. Go register to vote first, then go get the Kitty Kelly book, The Family. As a matter of fact, while you're reading the book, you can play the music in the background. See, you don't have to be Italian to have a family. Oh, and guess what else? Oh!
What?
Last night, I saw what is probably the worst show in the history of television.
Last night?
Yeah. On A&E.
Okay.
The Gotti, what is the name of that?
Oh, Growing Up Gotti?
Oh my God, that is the worst. I mean, the fact that A&E, which is usually a pretty damn good network, they've got really great shows. I like the cold case files. They've got biographies under there. It's a great channel. What in hell? Somebody must have made them an offer they couldn't refuse.
But I'm thinking, most obnoxious human being.
You know,
I had her
on my show years ago. She was a guest back in the day when I was one of those boring guests.
Oh.
And she was a pain in the ass then, and now she's an even bigger pain in the ass with her ugly kids.
Uh-huh.
And what was that? What?
Bunch of greasy burritos.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
But it's a reality show. Yeah, it's reality, all right.
Sure.
Somebody's fantasy, somebody's lunacy, that's going to stay on there more than like 5 minutes. 26 after 1, but Mount St. Helens has got the big cloud up there. There's a plume. There's very, very little ash in the plume is what it says. La plume des battantes. That's what Linda Blair is saying. Right now, Armstrong Ford of Homestead wants to clear their lots and sell off all remaining 04s. Here are just some of the great deals waiting on you. An 04 F-150 pickup, just $1 over invoice. New 04 Explorers, just $1 over invoice. Rangers, Crown Vicks, Tauruses, Focuses, all waiting for you at just $1 over invoice only at Armstrong Ford of Homestead. Plus, Armstrong Ford offers more value to its loyal customers. When you buy a Ford from Armstrong Ford, you'll get their exclusive Tires and Batteries for Life program. That's right, Tires and Batteries for Life. And the value you'll get at Armstrong Ford doesn't stop right there, because right now, you can get you a free Florida Sun Pass with any vehicle you buy. If you're pressed for time, Armstrong Ford knows your time is valuable, so just shop over the phone by calling them at 305-247-5112. 305-247-5112. They'll even deliver that new vehicle right to you. Armstrong Ford of Homestead, they're locally owned and operated. They'll treat you like family. No games, no BS, just the best deals in town. No bait and switch, no phony deals. Armstrong Ford of Homestead, you'll find them at 30725 South Dixie Highway, just 20 minutes south of the 836. Check them on the web at armstrongcars.com, and then drive a little and save a ton on that new Ford, only from our friends at Armstrong Ford of Homestead.
You're listening to Neil Rogers, exclusively on 560 QAM.
As our troops defend America in the war on terror, they must have what it takes to win. Yet John Kerry has repeatedly opposed weapons vital to winning the war on terror.
I don't have a clue who said that or what they said.
Kerry even voted against body armor for our troops on the front line of the war on terror.
That clearly wasn't true.
John Kerry's record on national security, troubling.
These guys are the most crooked, lying group I've ever seen.
I'm George W. Bush, and I approve this message.
Well, there you go.
Your vote's automatically calculated by computers at the GOP. Manipulated this time. Don't let the fascist neocons screw us again. The brother governor that's running Florida, no doubt's got another plan to get your vote done. This time don't let the fascist neocons screw us again. toward the blue and called Dirk's knuckles, my loins with thought of you.
Absolutely.
The Jews killed Christ.
Oh,
the Jews killed Christ. Bush is appointed by God. Rigged for Bush to win in a landslide this time. Don't let the fascist neocons screw us again.
.2702, Mad Dog at 2 o'clock, going to tear the Elephant Organization to bits and pieces, do you think?
No.
Sure he is.
All right.
Doug Thompson writes Capitol Hill Blue, which you don't seem to impress by this website, but I like it. He writes his commentary at the Rant every day or whenever he feels like it.
Okay.
Homophobia. You don't like this website?
I do like the website. I don't know what you're talking about.
Homophobia and the Republican Party. Was your mic open during that last commercial, by the way? I thought I heard you, like, clearing your throat or something.
That's possible.
You know, I think your mic was open like that.
The mic light doesn't work, you know.
Oh, that's right. The House and the Senate, in a rare moment of common sense, sacked President George W. Bush's homophobic constitutional amendment that would have defined marriage as a union only between men and women. That kills the issue for this year, but we'll be forced to visit it again as long as right-wing whack jobs dominate the Republican Party. Of all the extreme positions that emanate from the rabid conservatives that control the GOP, and there are many, none are more despicable than their outright hatred of homosexuals. They may scream loudly that gay bashing actions like the proposed constitutional amendments are not homophobic, but they are. Such hatred emerges easily from the same intolerance, bigotry, and racism that still infect the roots of the grand old party. Yet they look the other way and practice a don't-ask-don't-tell policy when one of their own is gay. Back in the early 1980s, Terry Dolan's National Conservative Political Action Committee was the toast of the right wing, while Dolan's homosexuality dominated Washington's whispers and people snickered at the anti-gay stances of the organization. When Dolan died of AIDS, many Republicans publicly professed shock and privately sighed with relief that he was gone. Nowadays, the rabid right wing idolizes openly conservative and pro-Republican internet gossip monger Matt Drudge, who bashes gays on his website, but who was outed as gay by Jeanette Walls of MSNBC in 2000 in her book Dish. Walls interviewed a number of Drudge's gay friends, including ex-lover David Cohen. Drudge's response, "My youth to me is a blur." Vice President Dick Cheney's daughter is gay, and he has split with the administration over the marriage amendment, saying such a decision should be left up to states, a position more consistent with claimed GOP policies of states' rights. Cheney's stand brought vicious attacks from the party's right wing. Such hypocrisy is typical of the GOP. They preach less government while increasing the size, power, and breadth of the federal bureaucracy. They espouse fiscal restraint while spending the federal budget into the largest deficits in history. They claim love of country while trampling on the Constitution, the foundation of the nation, with rights-robbing laws like the USA Patriot Act. And they talk of compassion while producing homophobia and bigotry. They claim gays are out to destroy the American way of life, a charge that conservatives would like to toss at anyone who doesn't agree with their narrow view of the world. In a Republican's eyes, if you question the actions of their president, you're anti-American. If you question his war in Iraq, you're unpatriotic. And if you dare suggest that people of the same sex should be able to love one another and live together as a married couple, you're guilty of crimes against God, country, and humanity. Like most bigotry, homophobia is driven by hate and fear. Bigots fear what they don't understand, and they don't understand a lot of things. Fear and hate appeal to the lowest parts of humanity, to simple minds that, in their own ignorance, cling to outdated concepts that a belief, point of view, lifestyle, or philosophy must be superior to another. These hate mongers accuse others of hate while spreading their own vileness in the name of God, country, and party, yet all they accomplish with their blather and bluster is to prove their own hate, bigotry, and homophobia. In the end, they're sad, pathetic people who should be pitied, ignored, and treated with the same disrespect the U.S. Congress showed in rejecting George W. Bush's homophobic constitutional amendment on marriage. Writes Doug Thompson, the rant. He's ranting and raving over here. 5670560, pound 560 on the Verizon and Singular wireless line. Think that's going to come up in the debate tomorrow?
We can only hope, but probably not.
Probably not. Probably the Democrats will, like, run away from that one. Edwards won't bring it up. Just keep saying Halliburton, Johnny boy, that's all, over and over again. And, of course, the Energy Task Force. WQAM, hello. Not there. WQAM, hello. 5670560, I love it when they run out, you know, when it's like somebody pulled a plug, like when you run out of gas, like Steely Dan. Because it's so obvious. I've never seen, talk about people goose-stepping in line, I've never seen, South Florida is a place where everybody just acts like in concert, like together. Here is South Florida in concert. No extra charge. They all run out of material at the same time, and it's like, which is a lot of fun for them. WQAM, hello.
The Gaudis have huge ratings.
WQAM, hello.
Yes,
the worst show in the history of television. Yes, sir.
Yes, Fred, calling from Hollywood.
Oh, let's go to Fred in Hollywood. Hello.
Yeah, but I'm on my cell phone, so try to get me on there quick.
You're on there right now, Fred. I'm talking to you.
This is what you missed, John.
Can't be any quicker than that.
This ain't Neil Rogers.
It sure as hell is.
Why don't you just hang up?
What can I do for you, Fred?
Fred, yeah, the Nadja Davenport thing, when he defecated in the bucket, man.
Yeah, okay, great. 567-0560. See, you wanted me to hang up. It was important that we got that. That was something about bucket and something that rhymes with bucket, which is what I'm thinking right now. Oh, man, I told you they were special.
You know,
WQAM, hello.
Phone,
hello.
Hello, how you doing?
Okay.
This is Neil.
Yes, sir.
You're talking about the Gaudis when you're talking about Passions on the Air and you got
yeah.
the Gaudis.
Right.
What's wrong with that? The Gaudis are a good show.
The Gaudis is a crap show, man. It's garbage. All they did was showing her what her designer and what dress she's going to wear. Get out of here. Get a life, you silly-ass queen. It's a good show, my ass. God. Passions is at least funny. It's a spoof. It's a satire. But it's probably a little bit over your head. You don't understand it. The fact that it's a satire. Satire is probably not in your... I mean, oh, it's a reality show, and there's this Gaudi and that Gaudi, and she's got to schlep around and get to the graduation. Oh, my God. He must have been an echo boomer.
At least The Sopranos is a parody of the Guidos.
Right. I mean, he was either an echo boomer or a Paul boomer, one or the other.
Echo chamber.
I think, in fact, probably Paul boomer because I can smell it. What best fits, who best fits this description? Celebrity whose death was least noted. Carol O'Connor, 120. Mo Howard, the real one, 70. Phil Hartman, 44. Marlon Brando, 39. Jan Barry, 34. You think that's for real, or is that like, are they playing with us?
I don't know.
Well, we never will find out. Frank Zappa, 33. Cedar Cruz, 28. Alec Guinness, 24. Ray Charles, 22. John and His Candy, 18. Dave Thomas from Wendy's, 17. Come on, put the burger down, Dave. On the biography thing, it's really... Oh, don't forget Eazy-E, he's got 16. On a biography thing on Dave Thomas, because it was done. It's a couple of years old. It's before he died. And they showed that the way he would test out, every time he thought that maybe the Wendy's formula was getting a little stale or a little bit, it wasn't up to snuff, what he would do is he'd, you know, find a Wendy's anywhere he happened to be, and he'd go through the drive-thru, and he would get his double cheeseburger with pickles, mustard, and whatever the hell he liked on it, and he would go out and sit there, and they actually filmed, they showed him sitting there, eating it. Basically saying, what's not to like? How could there possibly be anything wrong with this? You know?
Mensch, if there ever was one.
Huh?
He was a mensch.
Yeah, he was a good guy. 20 till 2 at 560 WQAM. When you shop for quality footwear, take those feet to a place that can't be beat, which rhymes with seat. At Brandy's, man, you'll find the biggest selection of men's and women's shoes, the best service and prices in town, period. What a combination that is. It is unbeatable. And they've got all the top names that you know and love, and usually at prices that nobody else even comes close to. Rockports, Florsheim, SAS, Sperry, Timberland, Naturalizer, and lots more. And with Brandy's humongous selection, you can just about bet Clarence's life on it that you'll never hear, sorry, we don't have that style in your size. It's on the shelf, ready to slap on your fat feet right now. Brandy's is open daily, Monday through Saturday, 9 to 9, every Sunday, 10 to 5. And you'll find Brandy's shoes at 1290 North Federal Highway in Pompano Beach. It's always worth the trip. And, again this week, it's a great time to buy Rockports at Brandy's because all great men's and women's Rockport styles are 20% off again this week. It's an offer you better not refuse. So be sure and get into Brandy's this week or visit them on the web at brandyshoes.com.
You're listening to Neil Rogers. On 560 QAM.
Hi, this is G. Gordon Liddy, and they don't come any worse than Neil Rogers.
Boobies, 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 shout the male regulars at Baghdad's new Hooters restaurant, located right in the heart of the one prosperous financial district.
I am loving the boobies.
That is right, Ahmed. And you will even love more the Hooters yak quesadillas. It is a favorite of mine, despite some customers may say that the cheese tastes a bit dirty. But at 95 cents, who's going to complain?
I am not, just as long as the waitresses have huge mukhtas.
You have that one much right. This new Hooters is recently converted from a destroyed elementary school on Akbar Avenue, just minutes away from any bombed-out neighborhood.
Well, my neighborhood is so bombed.
We are out of time, Ahmed, so if you're craving some hot camel wings, make tracks to Hooters Baghdad. It's Hooterific.
145 at 560 WQM. End of the poll, Charles Bronson. That's a good one.
You son of a bitch.
What?
Yeah, you son of a good idea.
Yeah. Even though it's late in your poll, somebody says Paul Wellstone. Well, we'd like to put him on there, but it says celebrity. He wasn't a celebrity. He was a politician. And, yeah. Too bad about that mysterious plane crash, wasn't it?
That is too bad.
Yeah, the timing right before the election was sure strange. Anyway, here's one that says, how about George Harrison? I second that emotion.
Sure.
Love George Harrison.
Right.
What's not to like? And it also says, go Edwards. Don't forget tomorrow night's the big vice presidential debate. Anybody care?
No.
It's going to be good.
Yes, it will.
And here's one from Lynn who says, one for the poll, Phil Hartman. 6 years later, it still makes me, well, Phil Hartman's doing very well. He's in third place right now, Lynn, with 44 votes. Also, she says, more importantly, my dog almost died from bloat over the weekend. He survived emergency surgery, thankfully. But all I could think of while driving him to the pet emergency center was the Michael Jackson Tommy Mottola bit where Michael says, I hope you get bloat. Could you please play it for me?
Hola.
Hello.
Hola, Tommy Mottola sitting.
Oh, who is this, the maid?
No, this is the wife, Talia.
I'd like to speak to Tommy Mottola.
Hello, Tommy Mottola resident. Gucci, Gucci, Gucci.
Charo?
No, Talia.
Talia, let me talk to the devil.
Please hold.
Tommy!
What is it?
You got the phone.
Oh.
Phone.
Hello. Tommy Mottola.
Speaking.
This is Michael Jackson. You lost your job. You lost your job.
Hey, I didn't lose my job. I stepped down.
Well, sure. However you want to paint the picture, whatever you have to tell yourself in order to save some sort of face, you do it. But you lost your job.
You know, actually, it's kind of nice to hear your voice.
What?
It's kind of nice to hear anybody's voice.
What are you talking about?
Yeah, can you hear that? That's my Mexican wife. Let me tell you, it was cute for maybe 5-10 minutes a day. But if I got to stay home with her every day, I'm going to go crazy.
You're getting your just desserts, Tommy Mottola, the devil.
All we do is eat Mexican food. Chimichangas, burritos, tostitos. I got more gas than Exxon.
And you deserve to have the bloat.
Listen, Michael, I'll resurface somewhere. I'll start another label.
Sure you will, so you can destroy the career of other budding artists.
Are we going to Chevy's?
Yes, honey, we're going to Chevy's.
Thank you very much,
all right.
Oh, jeez. If it's not Chevy's, it's Chi-Chi's. If it's not Chi-Chi's, it's what's that drive-in place?
I don't know what you're talking about. I called to berate you. And all I'm getting is dribble and chimichanga. Admit it, I was the reason you were forced to be fired.
Right, I know, because I'm very, very, very devilish.
I want to live in America. I want to live in America.
You're living in America, all right? Hey, look, Mikey, I got to go, okay? I got to take her over to Taco Bell.
Chevy!
Okay.
Chevy's, you want to come with us?
No, I don't want to be seen with you. You are the devil. So at this point, I am finding myself having some sympathy for you.
All right. I got to go there, Mikey. Let me tell you something. If I were to fart right now, half the neighborhood would go up. Goodbye.
149 at 560 QAM. I guess we're just out of touch with you. I mean, I'm sure that we'll probably get a call someday this week. Plexico Burress is a wonderful name, right? Plexico?
Right.
And the same with the Gotti Show. It's a great show. What's not to like? And it's got big ratings. And it's you really, I want you to watch it once.
I watched 10 minutes of it. It was all I could see.
I have never seen anything so grotesque, so pathetic. So there's just no reason for it other than somebody's got to make some money, I guess.
I had to screech and throw a fit.
Maybe the old man didn't leave her enough cash or something like that. I don't know what the deal is, but it's just, anyway, but don't forget, the Donald's got big numbers too.
Yeah.
The Donald.
Uh-huh.
These must be the Echo Boomers.
Boomers.
I'm telling you, these are the Echo Boomers, man. It's a reality show. It's Jessica and Nick. Rumors about them splitting up, by the way. Anybody care?
No.
Who cares?
No.
He's probably going. He's probably. She turned him around. And he's going the other way.
I'll take some casual sex off of her.
And I'll take some casual sex off of him. So there you go.
Lighten their load a little.
Right.
Just walk away.
Another Florida pirate fined $17,000. The FCC handed the penalty to Fort Myers, Florida resident Alexander Pierre Abelard after he was linked to an unlicensed radio station operating from a leased facility in his name. Abelard told FCC inspectors that he runs the Haitian radio network and operates the RadioIndependence.com website, but claimed that the transmitter belonged to somebody else whom he only identified as Jean-Louis and for whom he had no contact information. While Abelard said he wasn't liable for the fine since he had provided the name of the station's owner, the FCC noted that the information Abelard provided was insufficient, that he was indeed liable for the fine since he had the ability to shut off the part of the transmitter. Abelard acquiesced at the request of FCC inspector. Shut that damn thing off, you crazy bastard, before we put you on a banana boat back.
You are listening to Neil Rogers, exclusively on 560 QAM.
Stench of cow manure hovers over this performance by the Dolphins.
Sweet awake, I she plays.
Soul Train was on its parade.
Rose like us, we had it made. Those were the days.
And you knew who you were then.
There were no black Republicans.
Then we could use a man like Marcus Scott.
All the guys I knew were straight.
Whitey was the thing to hate.
Jimmy Eldorado ran gray. Those were the days.
Expensive attire, you cross him, you'll expire. You'll ride with the spare tire, the Gotti family. Sammy the Bull,
dead.
Elliot Ness,
dead.
Benny the Nose, Teddy the Trunk, Tony the Lip,
bled.
So if you think you are tough, there's people that you could stuff. You won't find things are so rough in the Gotti family.
156 and 560 QM Mad Dog, 4 minutes away. I guess it's, you know, it's a fad. It's like everything else. Oh, the Gotti family, you got to watch that. It's great. Right.
It blows hard.
It's pathetic. And I encourage everybody listening, who, if you haven't seen it on A&E, by all means, get it. If you don't have A&E, if you don't have cable, if you're a schlepper like that, then invade somebody's house that's got the cable and watch it, and you'll go running out. Leave everything behind. It is unacceptable. 567, let's get a few more of these calls because they were really sizzling as we got toward the end of the show today. You know, too bad we don't have more time.
Yeah,
5670560, pound 560 on the Verizon and Singular Wireless lines. WQAM, hello.
Uncle Nelson?
Yes?
I'm throbbing over here.
Okay, great. WQAM, hello.
Neil?
Yes, sir.
How you doing there, sir?
I'm doing okay. How are you doing?
I'm doing, could be better.
Yeah.
Going to the weather. Neil, I got a little bit of a spot. Have you had a chance to pick up the book by Kitty Kelly, The Family?
Yes, I have been reading some excerpts from it on the show.
What do you think?
I think it's great.
It is great.
Huge.
I'll tell you, I'm a 27-year-old Julio. Was born in this country. I'm of Julio descent, actually, and this is the first year that I'll be voting.
Right.
I just sent in my registration a week ago, and I got to tell you that I've never followed politics as closely as I do now, and it's just amazing, you know, how important it is that everybody be heard. And you know what? If you don't care, then guess what? You've got another thing coming. And it's just, you know, it's just been, it's just been incredible, my experiences and, you know, the knowledge I've been able to put together. And it's just, you know, I encourage everybody to participate.
And who are you?
Okay, and there he goes. I was going to ask him who he's voting for. I think I know, but I'm not positive. You know what I'm saying? Maybe he's just afraid they recognize his voice. He didn't want to say it out loud.
Gary.
Oh, okay. Now, who the hell is this on the bat line? Hello?
Hey, hello?
Is this Norma Kent? Why are you calling on the air?
I don't want to speak to you on the air. I wanted to speak to George Rodriguez for a second off the air.
What do you want to talk to him for? He's not answering the phones. You know, for a guy that's supposed to be my agent, you haven't got any idea how this works.
Of course I know how it works. That's why I was calling on the private, secret, hidden line that no one knows about.
You got your secret all right. There is no private secret. There's only one.
There's my cell phone
is right. What do you want?
I wanted to send George some dirty pictures.
Get out of here.
Wait a minute.
No, he's gone.
You deal with him
off the air on your dirty pictures. Okay. See, this is the deal. Over the weekend, he's been emailing me all these stories that he wants me to read, all these political stories, and he wants to send you dirty pictures. Go find a life, Norma Kent, okay? Maybe David Cohen, Matt Grudge's former boyfriend, will turn a little number for you or something, okay? Get out of here. Wants to send George dirty pictures. This is my agent. He's supposed to be feverishly working on important things. What's he working on? He's working on programming the show with a bunch of stupid-ass stories that I've probably already seen them all anyway, and he's working on sending a bunch of stupid-ass dirty pictures to George.
I hope they're pictures that I would be interested in them.
No, I think they're pictures of Norma and Miss Fudge naked is what they are. Well, Ellie, we can put them on our website.
Oh, it's in a compromising position.
There you go. Anyway, who best fits the description? Celebrity whose death was least noted. We'll just give you a few here because we're almost out of time. Thanks to Norma Kent calling in on a bat line in the middle of the show. What a jackass, man. Now you understand what I got to deal with? Carol O'Connor, 124. Mo Howard, the real one, 73. Phil Hartman, 50. Marlon Brando, 41. Frank Zappa and Jan Berry, 35. And after that, fairly small potatoes.
Bye, bye, bye!
Our special Neil Rogers and
Zorro.
Round the clock. Miami, Fort Lauderdale.
Mike Tyson.
They're all gonna-